Good morning and welcome everyone to this board workshop of Savannah Chatham Board of Public Education. This morning, it is the 9th of September 2020, and we are replacing our informal meeting with a board workshop that will be dedicated totally to the phased approach of COVID and getting our kids safe and learning. And I would like to make certain that people understand that this is being streamed at SCCPSS.com if you would like to watch it there. I'd like to ask Ms. Davis-Brown if this has been advertised in accordance with the state laws. She assures me that it has. We have a full agenda today, but I would have to say that with the exception of two or three board members who will be with us later today, I believe, who are with us on Zoom now, this is the most board members I've seen since March. And so it's good to see. Welcome back to Ms. Wade, Ms. Hall, Dr. Hoskins, Dr. Howard Hall, and Mr. Johnson, and Dr. Bringman. So welcome back. At this point, I'll turn it over to the superintendent.
Good morning, everyone, and we are indeed happy to be here this morning. We are excited to see everyone in one place and looking forward to getting back to our pre-corona status in terms of meetings. Today, we are proud to present the work that we have done thus far in terms of reopening. And we're ready to move to phase two of that, of our reopening. We have a number of reports available for your review this morning. I think most of the items you've received in advance, the staff is ready to present. I'd like to offer a special thank you to the Department of Public Health officials, to our reopening task force, our staff, and to a number of citizens and parents who've offered us suggestions along the way. All of those pieces of data have proven very helpful in terms of our thinking, and we just want to remind everyone that the work continues. So we have those reports ready, Mr. President.
Madam Superintendent, if we could wait just 1 second. We have one board member who hasn't been able to log in. Just a second, then we'll... I would remind board members as we begin that there's, if you look in your agenda, you see sections for the presentations today. Please hold your questions to the end of a section and then feel free and we'll discuss at that time. So, okay, we're good. Thank you. If you can proceed, Ms. Superintendent.
This morning, we are proud also and very delighted to have Dr. Lawton Davis, who was with us when we did our first presentation on reopening. He's joining us this morning. We consult weekly in terms of the status of public health in the Chatham County area. This morning, I've asked him to talk a little bit about the most current information, but also to give us some additional information which was requested on the impact of COVID-19 medically on the body, physically. So he'll provide that information for us this morning, and I'm sure we'll be open to questions. Thank you for being here with us, Dr. Davis.
Welcome, Dr. Davis.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Dr. Levitt, would you like for me to speak now, or was that just a general welcome?
I think we're ready for you, Dr. Davis.
Oh, my. Well, hope I'm ready for you. Good morning.
Good morning.
First, I would like, I think, to start out just with a brief overview of where we are, the lay of the land, the numbers. Everybody likes to talk about numbers, but what they mean and what, you know, they don't mean necessarily. And then we'll talk a little bit about how the virus seems to affect the body and maybe some long-term effects. So in general, Chatham County has been improving since, you know, roughly over the late part of July. We've sort of trended downward overall in several areas, and that is until the last few days. As we've mentioned before, I think there are several things we look, there's no one single statistical value you can look at to say, we're doing good, we're not doing good, oh, this is terrible. You have to look at a variety of things to try to get a picture of what's happening in the community, and not just what the cold, hard numbers are, but maybe what direction they are trending. And so the things that we can easily look at and measure and calculate would include things such as the rate of hospitalizations. And fortunately for us here in Chatham County and throughout the entire Coastal Health District, that recently has been declining, and that trend has continued through yesterday. So unless they had a really bad night, I would say that's definitely going in the correct direction. Another thing we look at is the percentage of tests. Excuse me, I'm going to mute for a minute so that I can cough. To my knowledge, I don't have COVID. We look at the percentage of tests that return as positive. And to get a good picture, you really need all of the tests. So we include the ones that are done in the hospitals, the FQHCs, by public health, physicians' offices. And I get these numbers from the state, and they come in about once a week. And the federal guidelines would say less than 5% is probably pretty good, more than 10%. And you're in what they call the red zone. Just remember, anytime you see green, yellow, red, you know, that's that's sort of general information and to point you in the right direction. But again, it's kind of what direction you're going is as important as what color you may find your particular metric sitting in that day. But anyway, in Chatham County, since August the 14th, we were 9.4% positive test, and we've been 9.4, 9.0, 9.8, 9.1. So we're just hovering right there at the magic 10% line. I can tell you that in just the public health tests that we've done, I looked yesterday, and for the past week or so, we have trended back up, and we're also back up to about 10%, 9.8%. And remember that we are testing people who are primarily out in the community and theoretically would be healthy enough to hop in a car and go to the civic center. So we're not testing the people who are in the hospital who are sick. Other things that we look at are a seven-day rolling average. And that's the reason we look at an average instead of just a single day is that there's some variation in when reference labs may run the tests that they receive, and a Chatham County batch may make it to the lab one evening but not get run till the next day, or it could even be put off one day, so you may have 2 days worth in one day. So we look at 7 and 14 day rolling averages to kind of smooth that out. Now, the best way to be able to do it would be to know the date of specimen collection or the date of symptom onset. We here do not have the horsepower to be able to go back and backdate everything and change everything and come up with that numbers. But over time, again, it all pretty much averages out. And we also are now in a happier situation where our turnaround time is 36 to 48 hours, sometimes 54 hours maybe, but typically we're at about a 48-hour turnaround, which is fairly quick. And we have been now for the last 7 to 10 days. One easy thing to do is to look at the 7-day rolling average and the 14-day rolling average. And if the 7-day rolling average is less than the 14-day rolling average, then you would think you're getting better because you're looking at the 7 most recent days rather than the 14 most recent days. And the converse would also be true. If the 7-day average is higher than the 14-day rolling average, it may mean you're seeing a little uptick. And for better or for worse, that's where we are now. Our 7-day rolling average as of this morning was 61.5, and our 14-day rolling average, if I can read that little bitty number, is 49.1. So just a little bit of an uptick there. And then, of course, we try to convert these numbers into something else so that we can compare communities of different sizes. And so we try to get to rates per 100,000. And the two most common metrics that have been used are the what I call the 14-day community transmission rate and then the daily new case rate, each, you know, per 100,000. And they're not exactly the same, even though obviously we're using case reports and they're all based on, you know, cases that have been reported in Chatham County, but you can't just simply jump back and forth between them. The 14-day community transmission is a total of the cases in the last 14 days that have been reported. And I think the idea behind it is, if you remember, there's about a 14-day window after exposure when people can develop the illness. And so we try to get a sort of a hazy picture of how many people per 100,000 may be out there in the community who are infected or recovering or are potentially spreading it to others. So somebody who was diagnosed 14 days ago but is still in the count may well be recovered and is okay and not spreading that to anybody else. But somebody who just got reported yesterday may not even have developed symptoms yet and is still capable of being out there and spreading the virus to others. So it's not a perfect, you know, metric, but it does sort of give you, again, a hazy or blurry picture of the community load of people who may be out there able to transmit this virus to others. And this is the number the governor has used in his executive order, such that if municipalities or counties are above 100, that is, quote, significant, unquote, and you have his blessings to adopt a mask ordinance in that, you know, municipality or county. 100 is not a magic level. You know, it's not if you're 101, you're going somewhere in a, you know, going to somewhere in a handbasket. And if you're at 99, you're doing great. But it just means there's enough of it out there to be concerned. And then obviously the higher you are, the more concerned you would be. And the direction you're going would, you know, play a role also. If you were at 150 coming down fairly nicely, that probably wouldn't be as bad as if you're at 150 and you're steadily going up. That would probably be worse. And so the Chatham County measure this morning is 270. So, you know, and the magic level is 100. And, you know, I don't, 2 or 3 days does not necessarily make a trend, but we have increased the last couple of days. However, overall, since those that magic, you know, late July period, we, you know, Chatham County has come down steadily. It's interesting that, you know, these last couple of days are right around Labor Day. It's probably too early to see a true increase from Labor Day activities, but that's one of the things we're concerned about. The other one is the daily new case rate per 100,000. And that's trying to pick up, you know, the actual number of new cases and express it as a rate per 100,000. It gives you a little more acute picture of what's out there and who may be infected than the 14-day community transmission level. But again, you can't just go, you can't multiply one by the other and divide by 14 and just jump back and forth between the two. They give you an idea of the same thing, but they use slightly different calculations and they're devised by different people or agencies. But you take them collectively to, you know, try to understand what's going on out there. And the entity that put this one out there was the Harvard Global Health Institute. And what they found was that in European countries who went back to school last spring, countries or cities that had rates less than one, that's 1.0, which is, you know, microscopic, obviously did real well. If it was less than 10, they did pretty well. If it was more than 10 or 15, they didn't do as well. And so they give a red zone. You know, again, you got green, yellow, orange, and red here for what that's worth. Red zone is above 25. But again, those are just guidelines. You're at 21 this morning. And again, you've kind of ticked upward here over the last week. I wouldn't hang my hat on, you know, 21 is okay because we're not at 25. It's just, again, it means that there is ongoing community transmission. So taken collectively, these last two would suggest that there is, you know, ongoing community transmission. It's of a significant level, but it's does not put us in the house on fire, burning up category, but it does mean that it's pretty, you know, it's definitely significant. And then if you look, the fact that the 7-day rolling average is bumping up above the 14-day rolling average, that would suggest possibly that we are seeing a little bit more of an uptick. Our percent of positive tests hovers right at 10%, which is the, you know, quote, the magic level. So overall, I would say that we've improved since July. We've got some work to do. We do have ongoing community transmission. That's the bad news, but the good news is that there are other places in the state that are worse than we are. If anybody has questions, I'll be quiet, and then I'll move on to some of the ways we know this virus tends to affect us.
Anyone, Ms. Wade has a question?
Thank you, Dr. Davis. Can everyone hear me?
It's hard to... Yes.
I appreciate you walking us through those different the different metrics and particularly where they were developed. The CTI or the community transition is much, much more rigorous and onerous than the Harvard Global Health chart. And so while we can be steadily in the orange under the Harvard Global Health chart, the CTI chart has us two or three times above the threshold for high. So I get that they're slightly different measurements, but the way the levels are grouped is really, really disparate. And so we're never going to be below on both of them. So which one should we look to? Because they are related. They're both, I understand the difference between the 14-day cumulative and the 7-day rolling average, but they're both looking at transmission rates. But the CTI index is much, 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 much more onerous than the Harvard Global Health one. And so how do you kind of help us guide that given the kind of conflicting information?
Well, I actually think they're pretty much the same. If you would look at, let's just accept for a moment that 100 is a magic level, and so you're 2.7 times above 100 on one of them. On the other one, you'd really want to be less than 5 or 10. So if you took 5, you're 3 times over it on the daily new case rate per 100,000. If you took 7.5, you're, you know, you're 2.4 times higher. And if you took 10, then you're whatever it was, 1.7 or 8 times higher. I can't make my computer move here. If you took 10 as the thing, you'd be 2 times higher. So to me, again, those thresholds are somewhat artificial. There's not a magic line in the sand. But you just look at them collectively, you know, and they're too high. And I think that again, trying to get looking at both of them and figuring out when one or the other is going to, you know, be in an acceptable level. Actually, I suspect if you picked 7.5, say, is okay, it's not less than 1.
For CTI or for the 7-day rolling average?
For the daily new case rate per 100,000, let's say you picked 7.5 and you want to get below that. Well, you're roughly 3 times above that, and you're roughly 2.7 times above the magic number of 100 on the other one, the community transmission index. So, again, I can't tell you that I don't know that one is truly, you know, a better indicator than the other. I think you take all of those things, the hospitalizations, which are definitely better, the percentage of positive tests, and we're under 10, but we're just kind of on a plateau between 9 and 10. And you take these two things, and they're both still a little on the high side, although they've both come down significantly since, you know, late July. And you try to pull out your magic wand and wave it, and you say, yep, we've still got ongoing community transmission. It's higher than we would like, but it's gotten better. But I can't tell you, Ms. Wade, that, you know, one is a better measure than the other, and you should hang your hat on this one and not that one.
So I think what we're hearing from the superintendent and from the public is data drives the decision. And so we're trying to figure out which data points we're to look at, and they're kind of all over the place, and we don't have a magic wand. And so I know it's not a clean mathematical formula, but people need to kind of know what the objectives are and what we're looking at. And
right. Well, I can't tell if I'm muted or not here. Hang on.
You're not.
I can hear
you're
you.
Not.
I would say you look at least those four things that I mentioned: hospitalizations, percent positive, and then these two, you know, metrics. And I'm not, the know-all whatever, but I would certainly say you would want that community transmission index to be trending downward and preferably be at 100 or 125 at the worst and on the way down. And the other one, we know that schools that were less than 10 in Europe did fairly well, so you'd like to see that one probably at less than 10, or at least approaching it and going down steadily. And I think those, again, I think they're relatively comparable, and I do think if you look at the two graphs, you know, superimposed or one right above the other, they do tend to mimic each other. But
they
mimic
in trends, but they don't mimic in levels. So for the 7-day rolling average, we've been in the orange for 3 weeks. For the CTI, we are double or triple the level of the high to move to the next level. So the trends are the same, but moving to the different levels, which is, I think, what we're going to tie everything to, it's much, much, much harder to start moving down on the CTI index than it is on the daily rolling average, at least based on this that we have.
Well, again, I think
I know you can't see what that is, but.
If you pick a level that you want to be at, let's just say 10, you're 2.1 times 10 on the new case rate per 100,000. You're 2.1 times over that, and you're 2.7 times over on the other. Again, those are when you pick a level that is somewhat arbitrary. I guess there is some data, but nobody has fabulous data. Nobody has, 6 years of information on COVID-19 and these levels to be able to tell you that, yes, if you're here, that's great. And if you're not, it's bad. So.
Dr. Davis, if I could interrupt you, Dr. Bringman has a question.
Sure.
Thank you again, Dr. Davis. What I'm getting, I think Dr. Wade is getting at too, is we as a board, along with the district, have to, I think you have a JD, have to come up with where we feel we're able to have an acceptable risk level. Less than 100 per 100,000 cases, less than or equal to 7.5 per 100,000 cases on the daily, less than a 5% positivity rate. And we have to come together and say, that's where we think it's acceptable to determine if we're going to hybrid, if we're going into more in-person. And yes, there is no data point that's going to say, this is the exact number you should hang your hat on. We might not ever get to green. I think that green, you know, less than one or one per 100 daily might not ever be achievable if COVID sticks around for years. So I do like the numbers that you've shared. I definitely think that I could discuss that more on an acceptable risk if we have other issues, you know, other options for our families that don't believe that's an acceptable risk. So I thank you for those starting off points in our conversation on where we might be able to draw our line of safety for our community. Thank you.
Dr. Davis, could you give us that second part of your presentation, please, sir?
Sure. You know, as time has gone on, we've learned, we collectively have learned a lot more about COVID and how it affects people. Fortunately, our healthcare professionals have really learned a lot, and people who unfortunately have to be hospitalized are faring better in general with better medical care. I think the things that would concern the school board the most would be, you know, how does this virus affect teachers, staff, and students, and are there long-term lingering effects? Initially, I don't think it was recognized that there are lingering effects from COVID-19, but we do know that now. In fact, somewhere, again, the numbers are not set in stone here, but somewhere between 10 and 15% at a minimum seem to have persistent lingering effects following infection. And these effects may linger from a significant case where, you know, you might have even had to be hospitalized, or even from a relatively mild case. So you don't have to have been really, really sick to have the lingering effects. But the virus affects cells throughout the body and organs throughout the body. It affects the brain, it affects the heart, it affects the GI tract. And I know you've read about it affecting the cells that line our blood vessels, the endothelial cells. And so it's really not surprising that it may cause a wide range of effects. The things that are reported most commonly are persistent fatigue, headache, vertigo, cardiorespiratory fitness problems or shortness of breath, and then problems with cognition. People talk about brain fog, and that seems to be a real thing. Achy joints are a significant part of it, so sort of arthritis or arthralgias. People have the heart muscle itself can be affected and trigger what's called a cardiomyopathy, where the heart muscle itself gets a little bit weak and floppy, and each time it squeezes, it doesn't squeeze out the amount of blood it's supposed to. We know that people develop blood clots. That's been one of the big things in you know, hospitalized patients, and it can also lead to strokes in otherwise relatively young people in whom you would not expect a stroke. So I think you need to recognize that in your staff and in your students, people who are confirmed to have had it, if they complain of somewhat, shall we say, squirrely complaints, you know, don't write them off. They may well be real. And again, fatigue, achy joints, tiredness, shortness of breath, and brain fog are the common terminology people would use to describe these things. And this may persist for weeks. In fact, you know, we're only 6 months into this, so we don't know how long this may persist.
Questions of Dr. Davis about this portion? Dr. Bringman?
Again, Dr. Davis, thank you. I think this is one of the other reasons that we have to start looking at acceptable risk. Everybody wants to talk about deaths, but nobody really is looking at, we should be trying to reduce the number of people infected across the globe, but really truly don't know the changes this virus is making in people that successfully heal from this virus. I liken it to, in the 80s, I was sent to a chickenpox party. I doubt my mom would send me to a chickenpox party now, knowing that I am now at risk for the rest of my life to have shingles, which is a very debilitating issue that virus is now, anybody who's had chickenpox will be at risk for. So we don't know. And of course, I'm not saying we shouldn't have school eventually in person, wondering what we'll find out in 6 months, 6 years. But viruses do change our bodies, and families need to start thinking about, we aren't just trying to protect children and our staff from death, we're trying to protect them from the long-lasting effects of a viral infection that we truly don't understand the ramifications of. So thank you for bringing that up, Dr. Davis.
Dr. Hoskins-Brown has a question.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Davis. And this information was something that I was really interested in, primarily because, you know, when we look at the number of cases, there's a greater number of cases in people who are, you know, younger than 40, but the preponderance of mortality is in people older than 50. So if we look at our exposure that we are trying to manage with in-person learning, then we have this population of teachers and staff and workers that are largely in this group that are more at risk for mortality. But then when I read about the impacts to heart disease, I became more concerned about that issue. So is the, in terms of, I guess, what is the emerging information about impact on the heart muscle? I think in terms of a gradient of lasting effects, brain fog and fatigue is inconvenient. And when you're still trying to work and teach, it's inefficient. But I'm concerned about these other long-term effects on breathing, on pulmonary effects, and cardiac effects. So can you tell me, is there enough information out about that yet? What's emerging? Just kind of what else can you elaborate on that?
I think the more commonly reported effects, lingering effects so far, are fatigue, achy joints, shortness of breath, and brain fog. The actual development of a cardiomyopathy, while it is recognized, I don't think that occurs a significant degree of heart damage such that somebody would say you have a cardiomyopathy from COVID is not happening as often as those other things are. So it is a potential adverse lingering, you know, problem, but I think the others are much more common. And I can't give you rates and, you know, data yet. A lot of this stuff, people are just beginning to, you know, really do longitudinal studies. Mm-hmm. And you have to have people willing to be followed up for a long time. You know, hey, I'm from the government, I'm here to help you, let me call you every week and see what's going on. Yeah, that doesn't necessarily go real well. But there are ongoing longitudinal studies. Several of them that have been published were shorter, but again, we're only 6 months into this thing, and they followed a cohort of patients that were in the hospital. In one particular study, I recall, had a fairly high percentage, you know, like 70% of people had at least one of those lingering events for at least a month afterwards. But in bigger population studies, it seems to be that the number is getting back down to that 10 to 15, maybe 20% that I mentioned earlier for long-term stuff. But I can't tell you how many people actually develop a cardiomyopathy.
Okay.
We'll have to consult Dr. Google on that one.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I have a question from Ms. Hines, and Dr. Howard Hall, and then we need to move on, please, folks. Ms. Hines.
Thank you, Dr. Buck. I really don't have a question, but I would just like to thank Dr. Davis for the information that you're sharing with us today, because much of the information we are hearing and reading about, much of it is conflicting at times, and we are just grateful that you're sharing with us information that is based on true science. Thank you so very much, sir.
Thank you,
Ms. Hines. Dr. Howard Hall.
Yes, from listening to the doctor, first of all, thank you for your information. The non-fatal COVID-19 infections that can be long-term and permanent can eventually result into a fatal impact. So can you talk the difference between long-term lingering effects as opposed to permanent? Because although these infections can be non-fatal for now, later it could be fatal. So the long-term permanent lingering, or just kind of explain a little about the long-term lingering effect as opposed to a permanent effect that there's no cure for.
Yeah, I'm not sure I can give you a great answer. I'll do the best I can. I would think some of the long-term terrible things that would happen that aren't going to get better would be if somebody suffered a premature stroke from a blood clot, because if you've had a stroke, you will improve. You certainly can improve, but there's going to have been some permanent damage to your brain. Likewise, if you had a clot in one of your heart vessels, you had a small myocardial infarction from a clot there, you know, that's going to cause damage that the rest of the muscle will rally and, you know, heart function will improve, but there's going to be some permanent damage there. The lingering effects, we really don't know. I've forgotten who summarized it. Viruses can cause long-lasting changes, and whether it's changes in the immune system that, you know, kind of smolder along. I don't know the etiology or the cause of some of these things. And we don't yet really know how long these more lingering, what you would call bothersome things like brain fog and achy joints. You know, you can keep going if your joints ache a little bit. It's not comfortable, but it doesn't, you know, you're not taken out of the game, so to speak. Whereas if you suffered one of those more serious side effects like a stroke, it could, you know, be significantly life-altering. I think we're just going to have to wait and watch and see what happens, you know, another 3 to 6 months from now or a year from now. Heaven forbid that none of these vaccines turn out to be both protective with long-lasting protection and safe. You know, one of the things has been postponed temporarily. It's probably just a statistical glitch, but, you know, we have high hopes for several of the vaccines, but they're not out there yet, and we don't know for sure that they're going to work. So I'm getting off track, but the lingering effects, I don't know how long they're going to linger, and whether people will have late recurrences or exacerbations. You know, there's already debate about that. When somebody has had the infection and seems to be better, and then 6 weeks later they're sick again, is that a new infection or is that a recurrence or an exacerbation of what they had before? I don't know that the answer is definitely in on all of that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Davis. I would like for us to move on if we could. Dr. Davis, again, we appreciate your changing your schedule to be at our convenience. And again, I, for one, know that I speak for the board in saying thank you so very much for the leadership you have shown in our community to educate all of us about COVID and what's going on. I appreciate your candor, and I hope that you'll have a nice day today, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. If I could make one last comment about all these statistics, and I've said it before, but just remember, statistics are like a lamppost, useful for support, but not necessarily for illumination. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. If we could move on now, Ms. Superintendent.
certainly appreciate Dr. Davis being with us this morning. We have a number of reports, and they are for information. We have this morning, as a reminder, we are presenting the information that we have put together so far. There's certainly still work to do, but I'm really delighted to have those reports with you this morning. At this point, we'll start with reopening phase two. This will be presented by Academic Affairs.
Good morning. The associate superintendents have worked on the return to in-person learning plan. As we follow the science and the status of the Savannah-Chatham County community spread, we acknowledge the numbers are ever-changing. Next slide, please. Adhering to strategic goal one, we're working toward a graduated approach to the phase-in return to in-person learning to ensure this is done in a safe manner. We're working closely with maintenance and operations, school nutrition, transportation, campus police, and also reviewing snippets of success in school districts that are reopening in Georgia and beyond. We also have a highly functioning return to in-person learning committee comprised of elementary, K-8, middle, and high school principals, and they continue to provide us with valuable input during this process. In addition, we also receive valuable input from our reopening school task force, which consists of internal and external stakeholders who participated in detailed discussions about the phased-in approach to returning our students to the in-person mode of instructional delivery. Next slide, please. This screen indicates that we have reviewed and will review on a frequent basis the following: COVID-19 transmission rates, hospitalizations, building capacities, information from Centers for Disease Control, Department of Public Health, and the Georgia K-12 Path to Recovery. Next slide, please. This is the tentative phase-in chart, which contains phases 1 to 4. Phase 1 is our current phase, which is all virtual, with several families opting to pick up packets, and we're also continuing to use the refueling stations. Phase 2, this is the hybrid option for pre-K to second grades, and also the least independent learners, for which parents will be offered the option of face-to-face or continued online learning for their children. Phase 3 is the hybrid approach that includes the grade levels in phase 2 with the addition of 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade. 6th grade and 9th grade are transitional grades that will also be included in phase 3. These parents will be offered, again, the option of face-to-face or continued online learning for their children. Our last phase, phase 4, would include all students in grades pre-K through 12. Phase 4 includes grades 7th, 8th, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. These parents will also be offered the option of face-to-face or continued online learning for their children. Next slide, please.
Good morning. We want to remind everyone that we started with phase 1 in a virtual learning setting. So currently, we have virtual learning for all of our students. We're We're operating under our Independent Learning Days playbook, as well as we're focusing on recovering learning loss for our students with our pre-K through 12 learning recovery plan. We also focused on professional learning for our teachers. They are becoming proficient and learning more in operation of our LMS, It's Learning, as well as USA Test Prep, Edgenuity, and other areas. We also began athletics with workouts and conditioning for our student athletes. Next slide. What we are proposing with phase two hybrid is that all school staff have a tentative return date of October 12, 2020. This return date to work allows time for employees to prepare for face-to-face teaching and learning, and it can be adjusted based on the data. We would retain Wednesdays as our deep clean day, at which time students are still engaging in independent learning as they do now. Also, we would have a parent survey to garner information from parents as it relates to their participation in the hybrid. As always, building capacity would remain a factor under social distancing guidelines. Students and parents would be asked to sign an understanding of safety and behavior expectations as they return. Next slide. So what does that hybrid look like? Phase two hybrid would include pre-K through two and our least independent learners, as Ms. Akins mentioned. They would return in cohorts, and it would be a combination of face-to-face and virtual learning. For example, cohort A would attend face-to-face on Monday and Tuesday. Wednesday would be an independent learning day in which they would participate in virtual learning, as well as virtual learning on Thursday and Friday. Cohort B would attend face-to-face on Thursday and Friday, with virtual learning occurring Monday and Tuesday and during the deep clean Wednesday day. Cohort C would be our virtual learning only. This would encompass grades 3 through 12, as well as it would be parent choice for those students in pre-K through 2 and our least independent learners. We also recognize that while we've presented a cohort A and B that encompasses 2 days of learning, 2 days or 3 days rather of virtual, there are other models that could be 1 week on, 1 week off. Next slide, please. So our safety procedures that we recommend is consistent and require safety protocol presentation. Those will be for pre-K through 12 staff, students, and parents by form of video, social media, and other communications avenues. Our cohort groups would remain consistent, so that would provide ease of contact tracing if it was needed. And then we've done social distancing in our class seating arrangement. And where feasible, as opposed to students moving, our teachers would move for instruction. We're recommending age-appropriate facial coverings for all students that would participate in the hybrid face-to-face learning, and then creating staggered lunch times, recess times, bathroom breaks, and any other transition times needed. Next slide, please. In our phase two hybrid, our extracurricular activity schedule will be developed for grades 3 through 12. It would include things such as chess club, our CTSOs, the art club, robotics, and our athletics, of course, have already been moving forward based on the schedules, volleyball and softball. Football is scheduled to begin October the 2nd, and there is a cheerleading plan that's been developed for participation in fall sport. Next slide. When we reach phase three, our expanded hybrid, we would then encompass grades 3 through 5, as well as our transition grade 6 in the middle school and grade 9 at the high school. The cohorts would still be the same: Monday and Tuesday face-to-face for cohort A, virtual learning Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, with cohort B seeing face-to-face learning Thursday and Friday, virtual learning Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And again, this is one recommendation of the hybrid. It could be on a week rotation as well. Cohort C attending virtually would be grades 7 and 8, as well as 10 through 12. Again, parent choice remains for our students in pre-K through 5, our least independent learners, and our 6th and 9th grade students. Wednesday would remain a deep clean day, and we would still have independent learning, and as always, building capacity would be a factor. Next slide, please. Our phase four would be complete reentry. That's for all grades pre-K through 12. And of course, virtual learning will continue for those students whose families elect not to return face-to-face at this time. Next slide, please.
A comprehensive phase-in return-to-learn approach has been developed for students with disabilities to encompass the needs of our least independent learners. The approach includes opportunities for individual face-to-face direct instruction, small group face-to-face direct instruction, as well as an individualized plan for Coastal Comprehensive Academy. There were two overarching objectives that guided the development of the plan. Number one, to provide an individualized plan to support our students with disabilities. Number two, to provide in-person instruction for students with disabilities who encounter the highest level of challenge with remote learning while maintaining health and safety protocols for staff and students. An individual direct instruction model will be provided for identified students needing limited direct instruction in a one-to-one environment. Students from the Language Enriched Alternative Program, otherwise known as LEAP, preschool intervention, and the pre-K autism jumpstart classes will be included in this model. Parents will be contacted for their preference for their students' learning model and transportation mode. Students will be placed in a cohort model that attends schools for half days on either Monday and Tuesday or Thursday and Friday. During the learning session, students will receive direct instruction and work on specific learning goals. Direct services will also be provided on-site, including speech-language therapy, occupational therapy, physical therapy, and behavioral consultation. All services will be provided in the classroom in order to limit student movement while on campus. Teachers will create task boxes to go home with students to extend learning on the days when they are not participating in on-site instruction. All classrooms will follow safety measures. Instructional staff will wear hospital-grade PPE, as most of these students have sensory issues and may be unable to wear a mask. This model will allow for students to be taught to social distance and to work on wearing a mask in a safe manner with the instructor prior to the eventual return of all students, along with IEP goals and objectives. Next slide, please. A small group direct instruction model, not to exceed three students, will be provided for identified students needing limited direct instruction in a small group environment. Students from the PACE class, as well as from the moderate, severe, and profound intellectual disability classes, will be included in this model of learning. Students attending this model of direct instruction must be able to tolerate the wearing of a mask. The same protocols will be followed as in the model prior. Parents will be contacted for their preference for their students' learning model and transportation mode. Students will be placed in a cohort that attends schools for half days on either Monday and Tuesday or Thursday and Friday. Teacher-created task boxes will be sent home with students to extend learning on the days they are not participating in on-site instruction. Students will maintain 6 feet distance from each other during face-to-face direct instruction. They will not share instructional materials or manipulatives. Each will have their own individual supplies. And all belongings will be kept in separate bins. Sanitization of instructional areas and materials will occur after each use or be placed in a specific bin for sanitization. Instructional staff would once again wear hospital-grade PPE due to the proximity students that is necessary for instructional control or assistance with restroom activities of daily living. Wednesdays will be reserved for deep cleaning, and task boxes will go home with students. Next slide, please. For Coastal Comprehensive Academy, there will be two options available for students. Number one is they will be able to continue virtual learning. Parents who select this option will commit to the virtual model for the remainder of the school year. Students will continue to receive instruction from their assigned teacher and other support staff. Option two, the hybrid model. Cluster groups of students A and B will be created. In the creation of the groups, siblings, parent choice, and teacher pairings will be taken into consideration. Group A will attend Monday and Tuesday in person, Wednesday will be virtual learning, and Thursday and Friday are independent days with online check-ins from staff by appointment and or schedule. Group B will follow the same schedule, but using Thursday and Friday as their in-person days. It will be a phased-in approach, with staff returning 2 weeks in advance of students, and students will be phased in by grade bands. Elementary will begin attending in-person class first, and after 2 weeks, middle and high school students will return. Next slide, please. Our ESOL students will follow the direct phase-in approach with our current phase of virtual education. Once the data determines the return date, a hybrid will be followed for students in grades pre-K through 2, followed by grades 5, 6, and 9, and the eventual return of all students for face-to-face instruction. For parents seeking additional options, we are offering the Twilight Virtual Evening Program to our ESOL students. Next slide, please. So that concludes our phase and return to learn presentation. At this time, we will take questions you may have.
I have Mr. Johnson, Dr. Bringman, and Ms. Wade. And I need to see the screen, please, so I can see other board members.
I appreciate the opportunity to be able to speak on this. And I would also like to thank the superintendent and her staff for putting together such a detailed phase end plan. My first question is, and I know we've been asking this, is where do the numbers have to be and which numbers are going to be going off for each of the phases to go into effect?
At this time, we are following the science. We're looking at the different models and the CDC guidelines, as well as the Department of Health. And so we're looking at the transmission rate. Again, we have the staff returning on October 12th, and then we would phase in the students in a hybrid that would meet social distancing guidelines. So we have not discussed that this community has to be at a very specific number, but we are looking to fall in a range that is acceptable in the, I believe it's orange, yellow. I don't have it in front of me, but looking to fall into the orange, yellow mode and definitely not be in the red. And again, we would be following the social distancing guidelines and the wearing of the appropriate PPE to actually return in that phase.
And I understand, you know, because we've all been told that we're following the data, we're following the science, but there's a lot of anxiety out in the community about what are the actual numbers going to be? So that way they can parents can start really anticipating when we get close to it, that they're going to be able, the kids are going to be able to go back to school. And so that's why I keep asking the question, what do the numbers have to be? What do the numbers have to be in order for us to be getting back into some sort of in-person class? My second question is based on phase three, and that one is I've had a couple of parents of seniors, and they also believe that they need the additional help with college application and options, and if they could be put into at least phase three for being one of those transition grades, going from high school to real life and to college life, because they do need to have a little more one-on-one contact with counselors, and counselors, they are overwhelmed as it is, but they were wondering if that could possibly be an option for that additional help that they can get with those school counselors.
What we can do, we can explore. There's no definitive that we couldn't explore the seniors as a part of that. But also, as we look at phase three, we're talking about opening additionally. So there may be some opportunity there as well, for some more individualized appointments and assistance being provided to our seniors, even maybe as early as phase two in our high schools, allowing them to come in and get specific assistance with things like college applications and so forth.
Well, that would be great if we could get them into phase two. And my last question is concerns about how we've already started school and teachers and students getting to know each other and knowing how they work and where they are, like students are in progress. By going to moving into these phases where we have some teachers going, doing hybrid, some teachers doing in person. Some parents are worried that either the teachers or the students are going to be moved to different teachers, or the teachers are going to be moved to different students who don't know those students already. Has that been discussed
Yes, and actually you'll see that in a presentation. We'll speak to dual teaching later on in the presentation. We'll discuss that further.
Okay, thank
you. Share that
information. Dr. Brayden, Ms. Wade.
Thank you, and thank you for working on this plan. I think we have ways to go with the plan, and I want to be a part of that.
That's all. Can't hear him. Can't hear you.
Can y'all hear me?
No. Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Irene, I would like to keep my mask on. Thank you.
Speak louder.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to ask the board and ask the district that we sit down and we have a really hard talk about where we want to draw the lines of acceptable risk at each one of these phases. I think that we need to know those numbers. The community needs to know those numbers. Where I work, they didn't have numbers, they just opened. I don't think that was a great plan, but it's the plan that I'm having to work under. So I think that we owe it to ourselves, to our students, to our teachers to have numbers at each one of these phases, understanding that the numbers might go the wrong direction. And if they do, then we have to, again, discuss what we're going to do at that time. So I would like to work on having numbers written down, having numbers published. I would also like the district, thank you for having a survey coming. Parents want that survey. I would love to see that survey data. So please, the sooner that can go out, but it'd be a good survey, great. And then I would like us to reevaluate what we're doing for our least independent learners and our disability students and our ESLO students. I don't know if a true AB hybrid model is going to work. I feel like they might need to be a specialized group of students that are allowed to come the 4 days that buildings are open. So I'm sure that that's been discussed, but I think that those special groups could be treated differently than our students that might be in the AB schedule. So I would just like to again have that maybe reevaluated for those groups. So again, thank you, and I look forward to seeing also the discussion on the instruction manual.
Thank you, Ms. Wade.
Thank you. I'm very glad that we have a proposed plan. I'm disappointed this we didn't see this in July, frankly, as opposed to September, but this is where we are. I do think, frankly, it is too vague and too conservative, given what we're hearing from parents about wanting choice. I do have some comments that I'll read at the formal meeting, but you know, the response that we're just following the data and we're looking at it and we'll just kind of see when everything feels right is not adequate to us as board members and to our community. The CDC has guidelines we could go in right now and reopen. The American Pediatric Association has guidelines right now that we could reopen. There's plenty of models out there that would allow us to reopen now. So we have got to nail it down. And, you know, do we have another meeting to have those hard conversations? We've been talking about this for a long time. At our last board meeting in August, when we had questions, we were repeatedly told there was going to be a meeting the following week, a meeting the following week, the week of August 17th. Well, no meeting ever materialized, and we never got those answers. So we seem to be kind of kicking the can down the road. We have got to make some hard decisions, and these are hard decisions. I get it. They're some of the most critical decisions in our community, but with the right leadership, we can make these hard decisions, but we cannot continue to tell the public to trust us. We'll look at the numbers, and we will know when it's right. And Dr. Bolivar, I know you said that. I know that's not your decision, but we have got to come up with some data points that the public can rally around and rely on, and that we can reopen these schools. I do have a series of kind of smaller questions. On page 4, with the various phases, I think they each need to be tied to data points. I am concerned that we are leaving the middle school and high schools empty while we work to get our pre-K to second back. I don't see why we can't also have our sixth and ninth graders come back in phase 2. Most of those are different buildings, and so we could be, you know, sort of slowly opening up each building. So I think we can bring those sixth and ninth graders back much earlier. it's been said a bunch, and we can look at it, that the standard to bring back our 7th, 8th, 10th, 11th, and 12th is basically eradication of the disease, which is impossible in the near future. So if we are really committed to this less than one per 100,000 on a daily rolling average, we're looking at those five grades not returning to school for a year or two. And I think that is not acceptable under any model. So we have got to commit to bring them back out of this this green zone that is really, really difficult to meet. So I guess those weren't questions as much as statements, but I would like you to hear why the 6th and 9th is not part of the phase two.
Somebody want to answer that, please?
I don't mind speaking to that. When we looked at this, we explored a hybrid and looking at adjustment. We looked at our pre-K through two and our least independent learners in terms of making sure that all of our areas of operation would be able to phase them back in. We are not averse to exploring other areas on a slow phase in when we're talking about phase two, as we are getting our teachers acclimated to returning as well. So that is something that the committee or the team can look at, because those buildings are empty. So it would be worth exploring.
Okay. Because, yeah, I mean, there's no reason for it just to be happening in some schools and not other schools. Page 6 talked about a parent survey. I think parents are more engaged than ever in their child's education right now, as many of them are sitting by their side as we speak, helping them do it. So I think a parent survey can be done very, very quickly. Most parents, like I said, are engaged daily in their child's education in a way they never imagined or desired. So I hope that is something that can be accomplished very, very quickly. We don't need a 2-week window. Parents are they're there and they're living it. For page 7, I want to talk about the Wednesday. I'm hearing that there's virtual learning, but then I'm also hearing it's independent learning. And so I'm not clear what's happening on Wednesdays in phase two. Right now, my impression is there on these independent learning days, there's not much happening education-wise, at least in my household. And so, and that's no offense to the schools my kids are in. So what is the deal with Wednesday when we're in phase two, and can we get to a more meaningful, impactful learning day?
Yeah. And you muted.
Dr. Cave, you're muted.
Yes.
I apologize. Wednesday is currently designed for independent learning. There are a variety of tasks that are to occur on that day. It's based upon principal and teacher choice. We have small group instruction that happens on that day. We have many students who are doing additional tasks. They're completing any additional assignments. They're also taking some kind of check for understanding to see if they have mastered the standards for that particular week. So there's lots of teaching and learning that still goes on that day. We're just not having all the synchronous instruction.
And why not? Why can't we just have school on Wednesdays?
Excuse me, I didn't hear you, Ms. Wade.
Am I on?
Yeah.
Why can't we just have school on Wednesdays?
Well, we're not.
We do on the other days.
Again, we're having the deep cleaning day on that day, but we're also not adverse to listening to another idea about having additional instruction. So we'll take that back to the committee, and we'll take that back to our reopening task force of principals, and we'll work with that group to see whether or not we can examine some other possibilities. Thank you.
Slide 9, the extracurricular activities, chess club, robotics, art club, are those in person?
Yes.
Okay, so we will have in phase two, the grades 3rd through 12th won't be allowed in the school for instruction, but they are allowed in for extracurriculars.
There will be some small group extracurricular after school. That would be once you're like in your elementary schools, your pre-K through two students would have been dismissed, your 3 through 12, and we will look at the high schools being spread out. We are looking at the numbers that would be on site, because currently we do have the athletes on site. And as we share, in terms of looking with the whole committee, that would involve transportation and feeding, we could examine 6 through 9 as part of possibly the phase two hybrid. So we're open to examination of that. But right now, as the plan is presented, it did include only those clubs coming back and doing a slow gradual phase in.
And to be clear, I support getting kids back on campus safely for any reason. I think it's a little opposite to let kids into school for robotics, but not for math class. And so because we're going to have all these choices and you can do it online or in school, I just, again, I want to get kids back in any way. But if I had my choice, I'd rather put my kids in math class in person as opposed to robotics. So it seems a little, I don't know, contrary to our priorities of getting kids actually in for the learning opportunities, although I support getting them in for extracurriculars. For athletics, will that include middle school sports, or are we still keeping those shut down?
We are still right now. Middle school sports are still closed. We are examining which sports would be best to bring back under middle school. So our athletic department is looking at that, but we have not made a determination on which one.
Again, phase three has no data points. It just says that it's dependent on community transition, CDC and Department of Health data. And again, the CDC has plans for reopening. Slide 11, the green level, when we actually get to bring our 7th, 8th, 10th, 11th, and 12th, I mean, that is just not a reasonable number that we're going to achieve in the community. When I talk to doctors, when we hear from Dr. Davis, it's virtually impossible. So we really have need to get our 6th and 9th graders in phase two and the rest of the kids in phase three. I mean, when we get to green and we eradicate the virus, I hope that means we can eradicate the masks and the screens and everything. Once the virus is eradicated, we can go back to normal, but we can't wait that long for these kids to get back into school. And so I just have a real problem with that. And I just think it's completely unreasonable. For slide 12, this, I couldn't get a sense with all of these, if this is a K-12 for this page, or if this is phased in by grade. I know you said for, I thought page 13 was phased in by grade, but I couldn't tell for page 12.
Right. Well, page 12 is not just Coastal Comp. So these are our youngest learners. Most of these are pre-K students with special needs.
I'm sorry, page 12, LEAP. LEAP is pre-K? Oh, I thought that was older kids. So this page right here is just special ed for our, yes, our pre-K through.
These are our least independent learners, correct.
Okay, and then page 13 is for
these
what
are
grades?
These are also our least independent learners, but these are students that are able to be in a small group. The first page, Ms. Wade, is students. This is individual, so this is one-on-one with students who are unable to wear masks, that kind of thing.
Okay. So I am concerned that there's, I appreciate seeing this. I hear from parents who have children in these programs and they are dying at home. I mean, it is not working. There are a whole other level of special ed kids that don't seem to be contemplated in here, who have IEPs or 504s who are struggling. And so I'd like to learn more about what we're doing with them. I hope that as we turn to page 15 with the ESOL, I really think just keeping our, I don't know if it's fair to say non-severe special ed kids. Is that appropriate? But our non-severe special ed kids and our ESOL kids on the regular reentry, I think is a real, real harm. I'm hearing from some schools that have significant ESOL populations. It's incredibly hard to get those kids and families engaged, understandably so, even with translators. And so I think there needs to be a more aggressive push for our non-severe special ed kids and our ESOL kids beyond just the regular phases. And so those are my specific questions. A lot of the responses to my questions were, we'll consider that, we'll take that under advisement, we'll go back to the committee. What is the timeline to actually make some decisions? I think a lot of us were surprised to see there was nothing on the board agenda today for us to consider it. So are we just going to keep thinking about it and looking at the data and contemplating, or what is the timeline to make these really hard decisions that require bold, strong leadership?
Well, I can speak for the students with disabilities. So these three slides, they're really on a different track than the phases we talked about. Our goal when we met with the superintendent who endorsed this is to bring them back sooner rather than on the schedule with the rest, because we hear the Facebook posts, we hear the calls, we understand. We are trying to get them back as quickly as we can in a safe environment. working with the parents, what works best for them. Some really want independent face-to-face instruction, and some are doing okay with virtual. It just depends. It's an individual choice. So our goal is for these students to get them back sooner rather than on the regular track with the rest of the phases.
Okay. And I would like, thank you for that. I appreciate that. I would like to see again, I think that's something that should have been part of this. What about everything else? When do we decide all this?
So, and I can speak to some of that. As you noted, October 12th is the date that we recommend we return teachers, understanding that we work with various departments. So we proposed a date for teacher return. But again, as we move forward, we will hear from different areas that will also impact a part of this, not just academic affairs in isolation, but also understanding just the special ed. We want to bring them back in safely, and we want to make sure that everyone is prepared to receive them and that parents do have the opportunity to actually do the surveys and make the choices. And we do continue to look in the data, but our goal is as quickly as possible and as safe as possible to return them to face-to-face learning if feasible.
And this is on me. I had read that, I'd misread that clearly, that the students return August 12th. Waiting a month to bring teachers back is too late, and giving families no date of certainty of when we're returning, even the first level, is too late. We can move safely and we can move thoughtfully more quickly, but we need some board decision action on this, and we need some dates that are sooner than a month away. We can do this safely. The protocols are not going to change between now and October 12th, and we need to give some certainty and, frankly, some urgency to some of these decisions. So I appreciate this. I think this is a good starting thing, but I'd like to meet again tomorrow to consider the revisions and not wait till our October board meeting. Like I said, last time we were promised a meeting the following week after the board meeting, it never materialized. And we need to make these hard decisions. And they're hard. They're really, really hard decisions, but it requires bold leadership. And I think we have that here.
I have Mr. Catchmore, Dr. Hoskins Brown.
Thank you, Dr. Buck. I'm going to repeat what was previously said. I've been hearing a lot from the community, parents, but I've also been hearing a lot from teachers, and I've heard from students as well. So I appreciate the plan that's been put forth and the work that's been put in on the presentations today. I do think we should have been discussing this back in May and June, and I'm hearing a lot of kicking the can down the road. It depends. We'll take it under advisement, et cetera, as Ms. Wade said. And I don't think that's acceptable at this point. I've looked at a lot of the plans put out by districts around the country and around Georgia. Many other districts have specific plans that were released months ago. Many of them have specific metrics that say when we get below this number on a community transition index or transmission rate, we'll move to phase two and phase three. I know I've been asking for metrics for months. And again, what we're getting today is the only firm metric is under one per 100,000 for face-to-face. And, you know, I agree with what's been previously said that that's just not attainable. Dr. Davis indicated, you know, less than 10 per 100,000 is reasonable. Fulton County is using 100 per 100,000. For return to face-to-face instruction. Whatever number we pick, and I agree with Julie that we need to set firm metrics so that the community knows what we're shooting for, but we need to be specific about it. And I agree also that it can't be that we kick the can down the road and decide to maybe address a revised plan at our October meeting. We need to meet again in the next week or two to finalize what those real numbers are. We talked about surveys. We did a parent survey and a staff survey several months ago. 65% of parents said they wanted in-person or hybrid. 60% of staff said they wanted in-person or hybrid. I see that we're going to do another parent survey. That survey should include transportation choices, so that we know how many were able to drop their kids at school and how many are going to need transportation. But we also need to survey staff again. Again, 60% of staff said they wanted to return to school last time. It would be helpful to know how many want to return to school this time. I've heard from several teachers who say they want to return to school, but that will help guide us if we decide to make in-person learning voluntary for staff and parents. If we have enough staff that want to be there, you know, we're able to accommodate those who are high risk and who don't necessarily want to return to school. We need to do more, as Ms. Wade again addressed, we need to do more for our students with disabilities now, not in 2 weeks, not in a month, now. I'm hearing from a lot of parents with students with disabilities and teachers who say that virtual is not working, we have problems, we want to be in person, but we're not allowed. And I understand the health and safety issues, but there are ways that we can do it effectively. And again, we need to give parents and staff choices. We need to give them options. So I'm going to reiterate what I started off with, which is we need more details and more specifics and benchmarks. I've been spending between an hour and a half and 3 hours every night for almost a month responding to parents, employers, business leaders, and teachers and staff who want to know what is our plan and what are the metrics we need to meet before we can start moving forward. And again, what I'm seeing today doesn't provide that information. I understand the need to remain flexible. I understand the need to take in a lot of data. I understand there are no bright lines, but we need to make choices. We need to set what those guidelines are, and we need to move forward because this disease isn't going to be eradicated anytime soon. And we owe it to the community to have a better plan than we will continue to evaluate, and we'll come back to you later. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brown and Ms. Hall.
Thank you. I appreciate the plan and the effort that has gone into it. I think that there are features to this plan and details that are in response to what we have learned about how the virus moves around, how it affects different groups. And so I think that, yeah, there are groups that decided how they were going to act with not as much information. And I'm not really swayed by that. I am happy to have this information, and I'm looking for some more. So I just wanted to say that. I did have a question about moving teachers instead of students, but I'll get to that in a moment. I think I may have come to this meeting with a different expectation than some of my colleagues, because I thought today was the day to sit down and talk with each other about all of the most updated plan, all of the data, and then have this conversation and talk about how we want to move forward, what it is that we will endorse and support, and what we think ought to be corrected. And so that's what I'm excited about. That's the work that I came prepared to do. I'm glad we have time to express our frustrations, because they are great. And because we've all gotten that feedback that says virtual learning, when it's not working, is really not working for some families. So I get that. And I'm appreciating the way the team is trying to address them. But definitely virtual is not as great as being in a healthy, safe environment and interacting one with another the way social animals do. What I kind of want to clarify, what I heard this morning, and I've been looking for these, I've been giving the number that says we're aiming for one, we're aiming for 100. But what I heard from Dr. Lawton this morning was that we need to be looking at a range, or someone said, I thought it was he, that, you know, orange and yellow are target ranges for us to move into. And so for me, target range of orange and yellow for the community transmission index, the CTI, would be between 99 and 50. Now, I don't know what phase we want to assign that to. I'm assuming because it's the high range of orange that that would go to two. Or maybe as a group, we need to talk about that. Like, is that range acceptable? Like when it hits 99, does that mean that we can move into this area? Or the same thing for the DCR between high orange of 25, high yellow of 10, whether that would work. To me, those are things that I'm willing to consider. And they're informed by data, but it's a broad enough range that we're not waiting for the absolute lowest number in the lowest range to take some action. So I'm putting that out there for conversation because I think that it'll start us in the direction of conferring as professionals to, you know, what we're interested in seeing. And if that's not acceptable, you know, for some, then, you know, we have to work past that. So those are my thoughts on numbers. That's what I'm hoping to leave with. I'm hoping to leave with conversation that has me feel comfortable about some metrics that we can, you know, that we can pursue. And I don't think we're far from that point. I think the advantage of the approach that the district has taken is that we have way more information to gauge how we would manage our phase in whatever rate we're using. So I appreciate the work that the staff has done. I appreciate the diligence of board members who have been emailing resources and forwarding messages from constituents. I appreciate those who are also representing the points of view of constituents, families who are just silently suffering and just dealing with this pandemic as a lot of us are. My question about teachers moving, and this is just a lighter kind of question, is that teachers moving for instruction and not the students on page 8. I found that kind of provocative, and I just wanted to know how valuable of that is an approach to mediate some of the issues related to safety and exposure, and how much are we going to exploit that?
So I'll speak especially as a secondary person in the sense that it would limit the movement that we would have in hallways and in opportunities for students to congregate and to interact outside of the guidelines. If the teacher moves, of course, the teacher that's leaving could clean their area. And so you have less movement among students and less interaction, especially as it pertains to common areas. So therefore, the teacher is transitioning as opposed to the students, and you're limiting that and the opportunity for that.
In the elementary sense, it applies very much the same way. Because as we know, when little people begin to move, there's lots of interaction, lots of social interaction. So it limits the opportunity that presents itself for them to intermingle with each other and spread anything that might be available there. So having the teachers move, it's much easier. They can carry their belongings with them on a cart, much easier to be able to do. It also helps with the contact tracing when the children are staying in one particular place and they stay with their cohort. So we're moving towards that in terms of getting the teacher to move instead of having all of the children begin to line up and then have to move from one class to another.
Thank you. It just seemed like a really good idea. So I just wondered, you know, what is our plan to exploit, exploit that? Like, why, under what condition is that not a great idea? And does that not get us closer to face-to-face? Because if you're moving a teacher around and you have a big plexiglass partition maybe between the group and them with some sort of passage, just seems like there were some real opportunities for that. And you've put together so many strategies, couldn't spend all the time on all of them, but that one just struck out to me as kind of intuitive and helpful. So are there any obstacles to that? Like, do we have teachers who don't want to do that? Or is there subject matter that doesn't help, that doesn't work with?
Well, I'm sure we'll have teachers, some teachers who don't want to move, but it really, there's really no negativity to it at all. We would just have to make sure that every teacher has a cart and they keep all of their belongings. In actuality, Dr. Hoskins Brown, we do it sometimes in our regular face-to-face because there are certain teachers, especially when building capacity becomes an issue. Every teacher, sometimes an EIP teacher, sometimes a SPED teacher, sometimes an REP teacher, they don't necessarily have a classroom for their own, so they're on a cart and they move from place to place. So it's an opportunity for us to explore carrying the learning directly to the students and helping them, allowing them to be still. So thank you. We'll continue to explore that as an option and make it more widespread.
And in addition, we've had the opportunity as associate superintendents to visit some of the pods. And that's where all the students are staying together the entire day. And it has been relatively successful. We visited the JEA, who uses the pod concept. So it is something that we really believe would work, and it would also adhere to the safety guidelines.
Could we move on now? Anything else, Dr. Hoskins Brown? I have Ms. Hall, Dr. Howard Hall, and then I would like to move to the next section.
Good morning.
Morning.
I too thought that this was going to be more of a conversational workshop. About 3 weeks ago, we received about 27 questions from the superintendent asking us to give our responses and ideas and our thoughts. And that's what I thought today was that we were going to come together and discuss those ideas that we had rather than kind of just listen to a litany of our frustrations. So I was very surprised yesterday to find out that the superintendent is saying she hardly got any responses from board members at all. So I do hope that the remainder of the workshop we can spend conversing about what our ideas are for moving forward rather than just continuing to hear all the frustrations that certainly all of us have heard over the last month. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hall. Dr. Howard Hall.
Yes, I first like to thank the staff for the hard work that they continuously doing. I'd like to thank the community for all of your input, and I'd like to thank my fellow board members for the research that we're doing. Just to kind of piggyback on Dr. Hoskins Brown, back in 1996, I served as an augmented SIA teacher, and I would pull my cart from classroom to classroom, so it's nothing new. We've been doing this for years. That's been well over 20 years ago. And I'd just like to also say that, as Ms. Wade mentioned about parents being engaged, well, grandparents are also engaged. I am a grandparent of a 9-year-old, and 3 days a week, I have virtual learning with her. And over 30 years ago, when I taught second grade, she's in fourth grade, I told her that to learn the order of the planets, the sequence of planets is the acronym. My very excited mother just served us nine pizzas, but now it's my very excited mother just served us noodles because Pluto is no longer a planet. So I teased her about that. We laughed and joked. But on a serious note, my question is, with the exception of our teachers who are currently teaching at our e-academy, would there be teachers that will only teach virtually even as we phase into our phase 2, 3, and 4 options?
I do think that we talked about we'll speak more to the dual teaching role, but that is a possibility. And when Mr. Ray presents with human resources, we will discuss dual teaching and what some of the options are, because there are various ways that could look. You could have teachers who teach only virtually, or you could have teachers that, if it was a need, if there may be a simultaneous teaching experience then for them. So those are some possibilities.
Is that it? Okay. Ms. Wade?
officer, anyone?
Thank you. I just had a point of my microphone. I had a couple follow-up comments based on the comments of my board members about the purpose of this meeting and the questions that were submitted. And the email that we received on August 30th said, Dr. Labette has shared the questions that she and the staff are working from daily as they continue to plan for face-to-face reentry. If you have other questions that you would like discussed or answered, please reply to me with those items. So we were never asked to provide input to the questions, and most of the questions are kind of operational anyway. I did supply other additional questions that I have not had answered today, but there was not an invitation in that to respond or to those questions. And then regarding the purpose of this retreat, if you have comments on the plan, tell us. Ms. Hall, Dr. Hoskins-Brown, if you like the fact that 7th, 8th, 10th, 11th, and 12th don't come back until less than one case per day, share that. I mean, tell us what you think. That's what we're doing. Yes, we're frustrated, but we're also sharing content on what we've been given. And at some point, we have to make a decision on what we're going to do. So everyone comes to meetings with different expectations, but here, let's hear the commentary. If you like that we have another month until teachers enter the building, and then who knows when there are other kids come back in. If you're happy with that and think that's a good solution, then you should let us know.
Ms. Hall, moving on, please.
Yes. First of all, I always believe in first listening to the experts, people who we pay to do this due diligence to help us stay safe. I'm a little alarmed that we've had two students to die through this virus and we haven't made much comment on it. And we don't seem to talk about the responsibilities involved once we go back to face-to-face learning. Everyone seems very concerned about their children losing out on their academics and their children losing out on their socialization. But we don't hear much about what do we do if we have a large swath of our parents, our students, or our children to succumb to this virus. So that's one thing that really concerns me and that makes me a bit more cautious than some of the other people I have heard about how quickly we return to face-to-face. I think everybody who is on this board wants that tremendously, but I think it's the path we go to that. Some are more cautious, some are less cautious. Again, I want to follow the experts, and since I am not an expert, I don't want to say that so that when something does happen to someone, I have to feel responsible. I rushed this. I didn't listen to the science. So I agree with Mr. Cashmore. Give us a metric that's pretty solid, but then also make sure everyone understands what a huge responsibility this is that we're taking on. We're talking about people's lives. I don't give a hoot if a kid falls back 2 months in reading if it meant that I kept that kid alive. So that's kind of how I feel about it. I'm ready to come back to face-to-face, but only when I can be pretty sure that we're not jeopardizing anybody's life.
Thank you, ma'am. If I could move on to the instructional options, please. It's obvious we're not going to get through with this. Who's doing this?
Okay, is that better? All right, thank you.
We're ready now to move to our next aspect of our presentation. That's the instructional options. Okay. I need to wait for the next slide. I'm not sure. My computer seems to be hung up at this point. Okay, K through five Twilight Virtual Learning Program. So as you know, we've launched our Twilight Virtual Learning Program for grades K through five. Our district approach, it's designed to meet the needs of those families and those students for alternative scheduling, as well as to provide those students who need it the most with additional support. All of the aspects of our K through five virtual program will be aligned, is aligned to our Georgia Standards of Excellence. The hours of operation currently are Monday through Friday, 4:30 to 7:30. We do release just a little early on Friday for those parents and students to be able to have some additional family time. It's open to all K through five students based on parent choice. We have the application launch, which we closed, but had lots of parents who contacted us for it to reopen, so we did that on yesterday. We'll also have multi-age classes sometimes if that opportunity presents itself to be able to serve a variety of students in a variety of settings with a variety of teachers from various sites. All of the sessions are synchronous, and that means they have live sessions, and we also are delighted that we have meal service. I'd like to give you just an update on the application process at this point. As of this morning, we have 137 children who have applied. We have 66 that are for tutorial, and we have 71 of those students who have opted to have only the Twilight option, so they will only be joining us for school from 4:30 to 7:30 in the evenings. Those grade spans, most of the children are in K-1 and 2 grade levels. We do have some children who are 4 and 5, but most of them are K-1 and 2 and 3, excuse me. So the schedule here presents itself Monday and Wednesday, and then a Tuesday-Thursday schedule. Monday and Wednesday, we begin that day with activities that are a little more light in terms of art and music. Then we move into a 45-minute section of synchronous instruction, and we end each day with independent learning. Tuesday and Thursday, we do something very similar where we focus on math and science. And Fridays, we have those additional services, small group intervention, as well as enrichment activities. Now, we're also thinking about our 6 through 12 because they also need Twilight, and Twilight is nothing new for us in our school district. So we offer 6 through 12 Twilight. That program does begin on September 15th. We have a site coordinator there. We have also, we offer it to students in grades 6 through 12. We use Edgenuity primarily for our credit recovery. It's self-paced, and it's a virtual model. We have a teacher of record that keeps up with the progress monitoring, and the hours of operation are Monday through Thursday from 3 to 6 p.m. So we're delighted to get those students moving along that continuum of learning. Then, of course, we have our ever famous CLR e-learning academy, which we're all very excited about, and our children are moving along quite well. We have an enrollment there that's a little over 900. We have the opportunity there where we have a principal as well as an AP. We have synchronous and also asynchronous instruction and lots of instructional support services there. Now, we do have some opportunities for growth. We continue to have professional learning for all of our staff because the virtual environment presents those obstacles and challenges that we need to make sure that our staff is prepared for. We also are continuing to work with our parents to make sure that they understand that while the child is in the virtual environment, they also have to be a part of that learning so that they become their own child's learning coach for that kind of instruction. We're excited about the instructional options that we have to offer in our school district, and we as a staff continue to explore, and we continue to research, and we continue to read so that we provide the best quality learning for our students. I'd like to entertain any questions at this time.
Are we doing devices in this section or before we get to questions? I'm just going by my. Is that still current?
You're correct, sir.
Still current.
Yeah, you're correct. Mr. Feliciano will follow up with a device update in this particular section, and then we'll break for questions.
Thank you.
All right. Good morning. The following is a status update on technology deployment. I'm super excited to report that even under COVID-19, even with social distancing, and even with people being quarantined, we were able to deliver requested Chromebooks, student devices to high school, middle schools, and K-8s. We have reallocated devices from school to school with Garden City, Gadsden, Port Wentworth, Brock, and Gould receiving devices. Today, we will complete Godly K-8 requests and start with the elementary school. So Gadsden, Port Wentworth, Windsor Forest, Juliet Lowe, Garden City, A.B. Williams, Butler will receive devices today. The rest of the elementary schools will receive their requested Chromebooks next week. Total amount distributed from the first bulk shipment is 7,524 devices. As to the second bulk shipment, we're expecting to receive it around September 18th with delivery to schools starting at the end of the month. I certainly wanted to thank the work from Edra Buckles, Tammy Kemp, Donald Major, Patrice Reese, and the support staff for working evenings and weekends to make sure our students have devices in their hands for online learning. It has been a long and difficult process. Student internet connectivity, I'm also excited to say, this is the first for Savannah Chatham. On September 1st, we officially rolled out 10 smart buses serving 100 Chatham County locations a week. Thanks to Sonny Batra, Tammy Kemp, Tammy Perkins, Charles Smith and his crew at Transportation, we figured it out and have moved from cows to wows. Each bus has two stops a day, moving from morning from 8 to 11 a.m. and afternoon from 1 to 4 p.m. We have been operating for 7 instructional days to date. We're seeing usage from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m., with the busiest time being in the afternoon from 1 to 3 p.m. Connectivity grant, we expect on September 11th to receive 30 additional Wi-Fi transmitters through the Georgia K-12 Student Connectivity Grant. These will be used on buses and student support centers. Concerning hotspots, 70 hotspots have been delivered to high schools, 20 to food and nutrition, and 329 are still pending delivery. I also want to let our families know that affordable high-speed internet is available through the Comcast Internet Essentials programs. No contract is required, and it is only $9.95 a month. Additional information can be found on a public website or at www.internetessentials.com. This concludes my presentation.
Any questions of board members from the last three? Ms. White has her hand up. Ms. Hall has her hand up. Dr. Hoskins Brown has her hand up so far.
Thank you. I wanted to start with the Twilight program and really commend the district for creating this option. I think we are in the age of choice right now. We're a choice district. We've been before COVID, but we want to give families as much choice as possible. And so I want to commend the district for pulling this together. And this is an option for anyone, but I think it's really tailored for maybe families who are working during the day, who can then assist their children with school in the afternoon. And I think it's innovative, mm-hmm. and I'm really excited to see it. And I'm glad to see families taking advantage of it. My question is, for the 71 students who are attending this as their only school, what happens to their, like, what school are they enrolled in? Like, are they, because I assume they're coming from all over the district, and like, just mechanically, how does that work with their neighborhood or their choice school that they were previously attending?
So thank you for that question. They will still be duly enrolled in their school. So if they are a student from West Chatham Elementary, they'll still be enrolled at West Chatham Elementary, but they'll have their synchronous instruction in the evening.
Okay, but their grades, so there's a connection between.
So there is a connection. Yes, so their grades, they'll be in a separate school within Power School, which Heather DiTomasio will set up or has already set up for those particular students. And the grading will occur from the assignments they do in the evening and the synchronous instruction they do in the evening. But it will be a report card that will be generated through their dual enrollment school, which would be West Chatham Elementary.
Okay.
As an
and
example.
Particularly in those younger grades, the curriculum is consistent among schools. So when those children hopefully roll back into their classrooms to be seated, they're going to be right on track with whatever that teacher is, regardless of where they are.
Yes, they will. We will make just a slight adjustment to the curriculum and pacing, just because the students are not having as much time in the evening. Because if you notice that hours in the evening from 4:30 to 7:30. So we'll make just a little adjustment, but we'll provide that independent support for them, as well as on Friday, that additional work that they might have missed because of the time constraints.
And then the teachers teaching that, are they also teaching during the day, or are these extra teachers that we've moved here, or how is that being staffed?
So we had that discussion yesterday. Our first idea was that the teachers would be put on an extended contract, but as the idea begins to grow and we're having more students who are enrolling in the evening, there might be an option for teachers just to have the opportunity just to work in that evening portion. So we did explore that, but right now they're doing an extended contract.
Well, and I haven't received the 10-day numbers yet. I've asked for them, but my understanding is elementary numbers are down. And so that may also allow, if we need to pull some elementary teachers from schools that have decreasing enrollment, we could do that.
And that was the basis of our discussion on yesterday. I'm sure Mr. Ray will probably touch more on that, but that was the basis of the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. But again, congratulations. See, I can't say positive things, but I think that's great. And I think these innovative things are what we need to get kids learning in whatever way that works best for the family and the student. And then I had a few technology questions for Mr. Feliciano. Is he here?
He's over here.
Oh, hi. We looked at the requested number, and it's 7,524 that were requested, but we have another 6,400 on the way, and we have, I guess, an extra of about 375 from the 8,000. So it was reported in the paper that there was a demand for devices that we were not able to meet. As I see this, I know it's taken us a few weeks. We've met the demand for all devices that have been requested. Is that correct?
Yes, with the shipment that has come in, we have met the demand for the Chromebooks. We have 476 over from the 8,000 of the first shipment. That's based on all the requests that the schools have made. Obviously, they're moving numbers because you have new students that are enrolling in schools, so we have to allocate additional devices. Another order that we have done is the iPad devices for the lower grades. I'm expecting those to be received at the end of the month, but we have moved some of the Chromebook devices to the lower grades, and the feedback that I'm receiving is that the lower grades like to retain the Chromebook devices for the smaller children.
So for the 6,400 that are coming in next week sometime, is that just for backup? Or, I mean, we're not going to have that much of a significant increase in enrollment.
Right, and that's a very good question. One of the things we did when we went into the schools is we cannibalized all their labs. We dismantled all their cows, and this is going to backfill to ensure that labs are still functioning when schools come back face to face.
Excellent. I've actually heard some concerns about that, so I'm glad that's what that's being used for. I had had some emails prior, and we never really got a final answer, but some schools are requiring families to purchase insurance and others are not, and we seem to have inconsistent policies throughout the district on insurance for these. And so I hope that that is being handled fairly, and that if we're not requiring students to buy insurance, that we're not requiring any students to buy insurance. So that is still a lingering issue with different results school to school. And I'm not asking necessarily for a report now, but that continues to be an issue that gives me a lot of concern. Turning to the next page, the WOW smart buses. I know it just started last week, but do we have any idea how many people are at? So my take is you either come in your car or you bring your lawn chair and you come and you kind of sit out in the 100-degree weather. And I mean, how many people are actually using these? And are we able to put them in places that may be a little more conducive to learning? I mean, I think it's a cool idea, but sometimes we have a lot of cool ideas and then no one takes advantage of it.
We are seeing a lot of activity, like I said, more in the afternoon. The most activity in the morning is around 9 o'clock in the morning. Based on the locations that we selected, we had campus police check them out. We also had transportation review the sites to make sure they were safe for our students. Parents certainly can sit in the car with the student so they can access the system to download all the activities and the lesson that needs to be looked at. We're also looking at using centers. Like I said, we're expecting 30 additional devices to come in that are portable. So we're able to deliver them inside the building. They can connect to the cell towers and provide Wi-Fi connectivity to students.
So I know it takes a while for new ideas to kind of, you know, for people to catch on, but I would like a report maybe at the end of September. Mr. Feliciano, I take it you're able to tell exact numbers of how many people are logging on and what times?
Yes, absolutely. We can pull some metrics. Like I said, it's premature right now. We only have 7 days. One of the things we are going to be looking at is reallocating bus stops, locations based on the demands that we're seeing.
Great. Well, I look forward to, yeah, report maybe in a month to see how that's going. And then for the additional hotspots that are coming, I see the numbers. So 70 hotspots for high schools. What does that actually mean? Like, who's getting those? Are families able to check those out? Are those going home with teachers? How are these being used and distributed?
Yeah, so the hotspots that are provided to the high schools, they go directly to the media center. And just like a student has the ability to check out a book, they'll be able to check out a hotspot device. So it's based on need.
Okay. And then what about for food and nutrition?
What we did is we provided those 20 to food and nutrition to use them for bus routes when they do delivery of meals. When they're no longer needed, they'll be reallocated to schools for students to check out.
Well, thank you for this. I have to share one kind of funny story. One school leader shared to me that they get so many cases where the parent brings in the device and says it's broken and they just don't know how to turn it on, which I thought was funny. You know, it's, our kids are way more tech savvy than the parents. But I know this has been a monumental effort to roll out this technology. Thank you.
Thank you. I have Ms. Hall, Dr. Hoskins-Brown, and Mr. Bringman.
Mr. Feliciano answered basically all of my questions. I just wanted to add that I was over in East Savannah at Creek Park, where one of the wild buses was parked, and about four cars came while I was there. So it's a very neat idea, and I am glad we're going to keep record on how many people do show up at these places, so if we need to move them, we can. But I think it's a really wonderful idea, and people are very appreciative. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Hoskins-Brown, Dr. Bringman, Dr. Howard Howell.
Thank you. I really appreciate the report. I feel like Ms. Wade, I think the Twilight program, I mean, we already had the Twilight program, but utilizing the Twilight program in the way that's being done is really great. What is, you know, we had a limit on the CELA. What is our capacity to use the Twilight virtual learning at K to 5 or 6 to 12?
Currently, we have no limit or no cap on the K through 5 virtual learning program. Dr. Levitt wanted to make sure that it stayed open, so we're leaving the application process there.
And at the, six through 12, we utilize it by site. So the sites actually look at their data and the number of students who need to recover a class or they need a special class if they're going to offer initial credit with approval, and then they enroll them as long as they have staff, and they can utilize staff from other sites if needed.
Okay, great. It really seems like a good option to address the needs of parents who, you know, can't support their children's learning during the day. So that makes me kind of ask the question about the 6 through 12 being from 3 to 6. How did we choose those times?
The 6 through 12 has always been in place, and we focused on utilizing those times because we have athletics in the afternoon. So we've been doing it for years, but we have to take into account that we have athletic practices and other things going on site. We've always done it right after school for them, because prior to COVID, it was a blended model in which there was some face-to-face learning. And so most of them got out of school at 2:30. We gave them a little break and report right back to site.
Okay. Thank you. And for the technology update, can we have a new number for how many students have a piece of technology of any kind for instruction? So we've heard about the numbers requested and meeting those. But earlier on, we were talking about people having devices of all kinds. You know, my question basically is, how many devices are we away from one-to-one?
Very good question. When we deliver the Apple devices, we would have deployed around 25,000 devices, including those bring your own technology. We would achieve the one-to-one.
Okay. Thank you.
I have Dr. Bringman, Dr. Howard Howell, Mr. Catchmar, Ms. Hines.
Is Twilight available for grades 6 through 8, regardless of middle school or K-8?
Yes.
And if parents just need to contact the district then,
if they have, you know, there you go. How do parents access Twilight for middle school, for grades 6 through 8? How do parents access middle for Twilight?
So for middle and high school, it pretty much works the same. There's contact by the counselor or teacher based on student need, but the parent can also contact their advisement teacher or the counselor as well. So it's a two-way communication. Sometimes they're contacted for Twilight reasons, or the parent can actually make the initial contact for additional support, and then the student fills out the application and is enrolled.
I have Mr. Johnson. Right.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I can break it.
Try it now.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Maybe I'm just bad at. Can I get a chalkboard? Mr. Johnson wanted to know, the Twilight program is actually teaching on Wednesday. What makes it different than our other virtual learning?
So our Twilight programs have always operated virtually at 6 through 12. So they've always done that virtual model and then online. And typically what they do is they do Monday through Thursday and do not operate on Friday. When they return to the building, they will return to a normal schedule, and Wednesday will be their deep clean day. They will actually follow the schedule of everyone else when they begin the blended learning model. But currently, we have a number of athletes and others that participate in the 6-12, especially the 9-12 program. And so we try to work their schedule so it doesn't interfere with other schedules.
So again, his question is, so then why can't the other schools do that?
Right now, because what we're doing is we're leaving the high schools on the same schedule that they're accustomed to, because when they phase back in, they will actually return to, I guess maybe I'm not understanding, they will return to Wednesday. Are you talking about the K-5 schools?
No, I'm talking about all schools instead of having an independent day and actual Sunday.
Okay. I got you. I think if I'm hearing you correctly, it's because remember that with 9 through 12, with our Twilight, they're doing credit recovery. It is not the actual total sum course. So it is on a shortened model. It is a condensed course. They're recovering credit for courses that may not have been passed. at 9 through 12. And so the timeline is much shorter. They have so many weeks to complete a session of Twilight, and then it ends because it is a recovery course. It's not the initial credit. And so because they're starting later and they end a little differently, we looked at how would we make sure we got all of the hours needed so that they could get the instruction. So in working with and talking to principals for definitely the first session of Twilight, they felt it was important to try and retain as many days as possible since it was virtual. Because normally we would have started earlier, but we did not. So they're making sure they get in all the hours for credit recovery.
I understand Twilight. Well, my question is, why does the
So on Wednesdays, there are some opportunities for virtual teaching, and I'm trying to make sure that I hear you, but remember on Wednesdays, there are some opportunities for virtual teaching. Teachers can actually set up small groups, they can do tutorials, they can support students as needed. So there are those opportunities for them to be able to set up small groups, one-to-one tutorial, and offer additional support to students. So that is an option if needed. And also, we tried to keep students to a true schedule. So as we begin the phase in return to learn, and my colleagues can jump in, but we also knew there would need to be a deep clean day, especially as you had students return. And so the goal is to try and give them a schedule as normal as possible to what it would look like when they return to learning. And Wednesdays will be a deep clean day, at which time they would not be in the building.
Okay, I have Dr. Howard Hall, Mr. Catchmar, Ms. Hines, and Ms. Hines.
Okay, yes, thanks, Dr. Case, for your presentation. My question is, what are we doing to expend our federal funds as it pertains to after-school programs such as 21st Century and our after-school tutorials? And also, due to COVID-19, are we using a lot of those funds, especially our carryover funds, since we got an extension for additional consumables? Since, you know, when the students return, they can have more individualized supplies and materials, such as the consumable books.
Yes, Dr. Hall. We are expanding the opportunities for after school. We just had our meeting with Dr. Hancock and several persons from the 21st Century Learning staff. So our schools will begin 21st Century Learning very shortly. We are also using those additional carryover funds for some schools to be able to have some after school programs as well, some after school tutorials. So we're expanding all the opportunities that present itself there with that funding.
Thank you.
Mr. Catchmar and Ms. Hines.
Thank you, Dr. Buck. On the instructional options presentation, I just wanted to repeat what my colleague said, which was thank you for developing options and choices for parents. Particularly with online learning and COVID, we need to be as flexible as possible. So I appreciate exploring those options and being responsive to parent needs. On the technology presentation, I have 2 points. Number one, I think we need to still evaluate whether we should provide individual hotspots to students. I think a student's going to be a more effective learner if they're utilizing a hotspot from home as opposed to sitting on the curb next to a bus or in a running car. And I think we can work with all the cell providers to maybe buy them in bulk depending on need. But I'd like us to continue to examine that. We're spending a lot of money on buses and technology to keep them running and running Wi-Fi hotspots around the county. The other question or the other point and question I have is teacher technology. I've had a lot of communications from parents where they were logged in and communications failed. And several times it was from the teacher's side at the school where their machines are 3, 4, 5 years old. So what are we doing to update or upgrade the teacher side of technology? We haven't heard much of that. Thank you.
Yes, that's a very good question. We have...
You're muted.
I Am I coming across? Okay. Thank you for the question. We do have several thousand computer devices sitting in a warehouse waiting to be delivered. We focused mainly on portable laptop devices, not desktop devices. Now that we have deployed the majority of the laptops to teachers, the student devices have been deployed. We're now looking at focusing on replacing the teachers' desktop computers. So that will be we'll be ramping up pretty soon to start deploying those to replace obsolete technology that's sitting on the teacher's desk.
Ms. Hines?
Buddy, had another question, a follow-up. Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate the reports that I've heard so far, and my opinion was voiced on several of the some of the earlier reports that were made about why we are here today. Mr. Feliciano, what provisions are made for parents or children that have to use the bus technology when there's inclement weather?
If the weather is not favorable to have students at the location, then obviously that day or yes, that sir. Location, we will not be providing that type of service. Safety is very important. Obviously, parents also can be in the vehicles, so they don't have to actually leave the vehicle in order to connect to the buses. The radius on the buses is over 300 feet, so they'll still be able to connect. We also have buses that park near some centers where the students are inside and they're able to connect to the bus that's parked outside.
Okay, thank you very much. And just maybe a follow-up with that, I've gotten several calls from parents concerning not being able to connect to our technology. So going forward, I assume this has improved?
Yes, ma'am. If you're talking about the smart bus, there is no password to connect. If you're talking about password,
okay. No, I'm talking about computers from home.
For the computers at home, we have cleared a lot of the password issues. So very little tickets are coming in with password problems or login problems.
Okay, thank you so very much. And let me just ask one other question to the previous presentation. About the instructional options. Is it possible that students who may have fallen behind because of pre-COVID and where we are now, will they be able to use the will they be able to log in for reviews with the after-school program that you spoke about earlier, Mrs. Ball-Oliver?
So yes, our teachers do have tutorial options for them, and they can log on with after school office hours. Twilight is more geared towards actually recovering of credit.
Right.
You can also use it to recover standards and content that's not mastered. Teachers can also use it for that time as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. If I could move on now to functionality number three. You're not.
Is that better?
Yeah.
I'm good. A lot of the information, the presentations from operations was shared with you in May based on the capacity of the building. We've looked at how many students will be able to accommodate if we were continuing to follow the guidelines of 50% with the 6 feet distancing of each of the classrooms. We'll share with you some of the pilots. We've gone into some of those buildings, actually social distance some of them. This is some of the data from those particular pilots that we selected. You'll see the elementary, middle, and some of the high schools. And if we were following the 50% capacity of a building, what the existing capacity of those facilities are, and then the number of students that we'll be able. You'll see that we used our previous year enrollment, basically waiting for new data to be provided. Just a quick look at some of the classrooms that we have gone in. You'll see us make the recommendation that we remove the rugs, even though we know that that is very important in a lot of those schools, but it's gonna be important that we make sure that they continue to be clean and sanitized. We have changed our model as it relates to removing the furniture from the classroom, because if we remove 50%, then we're going to have some place to store. So what you'll see us doing now is making sure we're marking those off that will not be available for use, and we'll continue to monitor and work with staff to see that that remains in place. You had a presentation, so it's okay if I just skip around to some of the ones that I think that are critical for you as a part of your discussion. So we looked at our overall capacity district-wide, looked at enrollment for 2019. If we continue to follow those guidelines that are 50% of capacity, you see at the elementary school level, the number of seats is about 18,600. Enrollment in the elementary grades was about 13. So if we were monitoring and we continue to set the rooms for 50%, we could only accommodate about 9,300 of those students. If we decide to social distance at about 75%, have kids in masks, is that an opportunity for us to consider? Then we're at a point where we can accommodate 13,950. So what we're doing is providing scenarios for your consideration, and you'll see that in each of the grade bands. We looked at our K-8 buildings, middle school, high schools, and then you see the total capacity across the district as it relates to seats, if we can accommodate at 50%, and if we were going to take a look at 75% of a particular room. So we wanted to be able to provide you as much data as we could as we make our decisions moving forward. Again, we do have some schools that we know will be a challenge for us. Those are some of our larger schools where we have more, we're over 100% of capacity based on last year's enrollment. That was Hess K-8, naturally at Godley Station, and Islands High School as it relates to our maintenance. I'll talk a little bit about, we've been responsible in operations for providing PPEs. We've ordered them and we've been distributing. We've been fortunate enough to receive PPEs from the state. We have already distributed those between all of the buildings to include our charter schools. They've received their portion of the supplies as well. We made sure that we looked at what the enrollment projections were, what we had last year. We've distributed those masks and other. Air quality is something that we're certainly taking a look at. We want to be able to reduce bacteria and mold spores in the school. So we're looking at a phased approach to install bipolar ionization units as a part of our HVAC system. But as we talked earlier, we're already running our systems around the clock. Deep cleaning Wednesday, we're making sure whenever we're face-to-face that we have an opportunity to have our custodial staff go in uninhibited and make sure all of those classrooms are clean. We've had the discussion as it relates to what we refer to as Jack and Jill bathrooms in our elementary and our lower grade schools. That's going to be a challenge for us as those students. But we're looking to partner with our instructional staff as well as our custodial staff that those bathrooms are always clean and we have the necessary products in there to ensure that they're clean. Don't want to disrupt the instructional process by having students have to use the group bathrooms, but want to take advantage of those Jack and Jill bathrooms, but it's certainly paramount that those are cleaned at all times. So we're continuing to order supplies. We do have additional supplies. Want to make sure that as we prepare for face-to-face, we have what we need in those schools to provide that cleaning support. Just a little bit about the supplies that we currently have that are in stock. We're distributing those to the schools, making those available. Again, the supplies that we have received from RESA, the quantities and what has been distributed to our schools as well as to the charter schools, all of the schools have received those. We've looked at the hybrids that's being proposed, so we'll build our model around face-to-face and each of those phases that will be brought forward by our academic team. So this is just telling you we looked at each of those, and that's how we're going to build what our responsibilities are to support those. I can move to the next section, or we can have questions as it relates to maintenance and operations. Transportation would be the next one. And I'm not rushing, but I just want to make sure that all of my colleagues have an opportunity to present the valuable information to you today as well.
Let's move on and okay. then we'll come
Should
back.
If you have any questions, we'll certainly right. be able to answer those for you. We'll take a look. Am I sharing there? Is it there?
Yeah.
No, I'm trying to leave that one to go to.
You got to stop, share, and talk, red button. There you go.
Okay, then I have to go back in and reshare. Okay, let's go to transportation. Talk a little bit about bus capacity. We shared this information with you. We'll be at 55% of a bus. So once we make the decision face-to-face and what those days will be, then certainly we're gonna have the conversation as it relates to bell schedules. It's based on being able to socially distance students on the buses, having monitors on the bus as well as the driver. Then in order to get our students, we transport over 27,000 students a day. Then based on those guidelines for making sure that we socially distance them, an 84-passenger bus, we're only able to accommodate 46 students, and that is with two students on a seat. So that's certainly, we're gonna have to make sure that we're having those conversations relative to schedules. We do what we refer to as double backs. That's gonna continue to be a challenge for us. So you see each of the capacities at 55% of a bus, you'll see the number of students that will be able to safely transport on each bus. Just some information relative to what that would look like on a bus, the number of seats that we would be able to use, just as we shared with you previously. Again, the impact that it would have on us, the number of drivers, the number of routes. We did do some analysis to see what bell schedules could possibly look at based on the fact, heard Mr. Katchmar make the recommendation as it relates to the upcoming survey. Parents are gonna, we're gonna need parent support in this effort. If we're gonna go back to school in a pandemic, you certainly see that we have to continue to social distance. Those kids who want transportation, it is our desire to provide it. We're gonna have to be very creative and innovative, and it is gonna have to have some support from parents as it relates to how we get those students to school. So we wanted to be able to show you the number of students, the number of routes that we currently have as well. Again, we took the data from our academic colleagues. We took our information. We'll be prepared to provide support as it relates to transportation and all of the models that are being proposed for consideration. For us, as it relates to safety, making sure that the buses are sanitized between the AM and the PM. If we're still gonna be running a hybrid, then we'll have to take into consideration will we continue to be able to provide meal delivery during that time and just how those schedules will work. Ventilation as it relates to the buses, whenever permitted based on the weather, windows shall be down. We'll be loading buses from the back forward. That reduces the amount of transition and kids next to each other is what we'll be doing, making sure the drivers and monitors all have on the required PPEs. We'll move right into school nutrition. We've already served close to, let me see if I let me share this one. Got a lot of sharing going on here. We've served over 33,000 meals thus far since we've been back in school to our students. We've just recently received information that the USDA seamless waiver has been implemented. We do have information from the state. So next week, we will be moving forward with providing meals to all students. We were providing our free and reduced students and our paid students as well. But just as we did in the spring, we'll now be in a position where we can provide meals to all students regardless of your status or your eligibility. So we're excited to be able to offer that to our families as well. Again, with school nutrition, we took the exact models that are being proposed by our academic teams, and that's how we will make sure that we provide meals. Students will not eat lunch in the cafeterias. We're prepared to have box lunches. We'll get that inventory based on student enrollment when we're face-to-face. Then students will then come pick up the boxes. They'll be eating their lunch. Their lunch is in the classroom. Again, that's going to require us to have additional staff to make sure that we're keeping those classrooms clean, that we're disposing debris in a timely manner. As relates to our spare kids who will be back in school, we're willing to support the learning students. Our Twilight program will provide meals for those students as well. Whenever kids are in class, if they're in class for 3 days and they're out for two, it is our intent to have them to take meals home with them. So we're not necessarily having to deliver meals on the 2 days that they're home virtual. We'll prepare those meals, have them packed for them to go on the last day that they're in the building. So that will then reduce the delivery of certain areas. So we'll be paying attention to that. We'll be having families now. We're going to be looking at an opportunity to have families register, how we could possibly have them register. If you're interested in participating in the program to provide meals, tell us that. That will help us make sure that we can provide meals where necessary, because we're going to be operating buses in a dual format. We'll be transporting kids to school as well as delivering meals. So if we don't have any other specific areas based on the documents that were provided to you, then certainly all of the members of operations are on the line and we'll be more than happy to take your questions.
I've got Dr. Bringman first, Dr. Howard Hall after that.
See if I can get my mic to work. Is that working?
Can hear you.
Yeah. Okay, great. I'm going to ask one on each of the presentations. Do you see any anticipated redistricting to accommodate the 50% social distance occupancy? I know in some of our areas we're already well above the 100% occupancy of the building. I don't expect an answer right now, but I've had parents that are concerned that if we go back to this 50%, if everybody in their area wants to go back face-to-face, then we have to redistrict. So.
And what you will see us do is take a look at those buildings where we can use the cafeteria space, because students will not be eating there. They'll be in their individual classrooms. You'll see us start sectioning off that particular area. We'll partition it off and make that space available for instruction as well.
Thank you. On busing, thank you for understanding that, you know, perfect social distancing isn't going to be able to be a reality for busing our 24,000+ students that we bus every day in a normal school year. So I like that you've given us numbers on what might be an acceptable risk to bus our children back to school. So thank you for that. And then just one comment on food delivery. I love that we're trying to get lunch and breakfast back at no cost to everybody. Some of the delivery times are at the dead heat of everybody's in their Zoom meeting. And it's might be more easily accomplished now that the children might not have to be there, or the parent might have to have all the numbers if we're just giving it at no cost like it was in the summer where you could just walk up and say, can I get 5 children's worth of meals? That might alleviate some of that problems, because I know that I've had some families are like, I can't go pick up the food at 10:10 because I have 3 kids that are all in a Zoom at that time and I can't leave them and go. So I think that maybe that will rectify itself with the no cost, both breakfast and lunch, and representative can pick it up.
Right, and that's the information we need, because we can work to modify that bus stop time, because we're trying to work very closely with academics to make sure that we're not disrupting the instructional time between when we have so many buses and so many drivers. But certainly, if that is creating a challenge, our drivers are working very hard. If a parent comes and they have left the stop and we get that call, we do have what we refer to as standby drivers and standby buses that then go back into a particular area. So if that is occurring, we encourage our parents to give us a call. We have them strategically located throughout the county, and we can go back. But certainly, if it's necessary that we take a look at that time of delivery, we can make those adjustments.
Thank you.
Dr. Howard Hall, Mr. Johnson, Ms. Wade.
Yes, I have several questions, and I just prefer to ask them all at one time, and if I have to go back, I will. The first one, will we have plexiglass partitions in some of the classrooms? I have a friend that teaches in Duval County, And she said they used the plexiglass to have a mask break, give the kids the opportunity, like I'm doing now, taking off this shield, mm-hmm. get a chance of have some plexiglass options.
We have looked at the costs associated with plexiglass. I think at the beginning of the pandemic, they were about $100 each. They're now at about $150 each. So we calculate that need is close to about $5.6 million. Where we have those special needs, i.e. with some of our SPED students, we're working very diligently to accommodate that particular population. But what we're hoping that we'll continue to do is utilize masks and utilize face shields.
Okay, and also I know that we're going to be hiring additional custodians to help with the sanitizing. So have we began to advertise for those positions, or we have
fortunately, we've received our budget allocation as it relates to the CARES funding. So we will be advertising for custodians. That particular group has been a challenge for us, not in a pandemic, especially in certain areas where right. there's not public transportation.
Right.
You'll see it in Western Chatham County. You'll see it in the 17th area where we don't, a lot of our staff without vehicles, that public transportation is just not available. So we're looking at that as an option. We're looking at if there's going to be an option to stagger shifts with the staff we currently have, stagger schedules, but certainly we will be recruiting. We've already reached out to our temporary agency that we've used for teachers. We've not had any success there. So then we're going to have to become creative and determine how we're going to have to go out and recruit. We've also created kind of an alternate job description for other areas. So if you're a bus driver, if you're a monitor, if you're in another area in transportation and you want to see yourself in a school building, then we have an opportunity for you to move over to some of those positions as well.
Okay, then finally, we have some teachers that are teachers from home, and they will prefer to be in the school building, but due to no child care. So have we explored an option that they may possibly can bring their children to their classroom during this time?
I'm not sure if that's a Vanessa question to answer. Because you might not like Vanessa answer. what we're doing is we're making sure that we're balancing the need of academics, which is paramount, but safety is also in this pandemic, because we've heard the conversations and we continue to have them, because we just don't know what this virus is going to do. So again, that's not a call for me. What I do tell you is what the capacity of a building is. So as you bring more people in the building, if you bring more students in the building, if you bring children in with staff, then we do see your capacity to operate diminish. So those are things that I look at from a facility standpoint and a safety standpoint. I'm counting the beans. We're being flexible. We're trying to be creative, but we're also making sure that we're keeping all who are in those buildings safe.
Thank you.
I have Mr. Johnson, Ms. Wade, and Ms. Hines.
Can everybody hear me?
I can hear you, sir.
I was wondering, could we get a report of the 50% and 75% capacity for each school and not just the grade bands? Because I think that would be very helpful, especially with some of those schools might want to have more parents. Once we get into the phasing in the options, we might have a situation where more parents than what the capacity will allow want to have that in-person option. Have we discussed on how we would handle that in situations where we have more families wanting to come in person than seating's allowed?
Like you heard me say a few minutes ago, we'll be looking at all possible areas within that building where we could possibly utilize. Again, you'll see us possibly looking at some of the labs. I see us looking at some of those cafeterias. It's going to be very difficult for us to do it in the gymnasium. You've heard academic comments about the opportunity of having teachers on carts and on wheels actually going to the students. But what you saw as a part of that original presentation is we took a pilot of the schools, but we have the numbers for all of them as it relates to what 50% or 75% of a building will look like, and we'll certainly get that to Dr. Levesque to disseminate to you.
Okay, thank you. And on that same presentation when you were talking about the isolation units. Mm-hmm. My question is, why weren't we able to get that started sooner for insulation, considering we knew that the virus wasn't going to be kind of really going anywhere?
And we've looked at several different models and opportunities, and we wanted to at least put a timeline because funding was one of the issues. So what we want to go ahead and do now, what I've asked our maintenance and operation team, is to go ahead and let's transfer some of our existing general fund money that we have in operation. We're waiting for our CARES Act money to be allocated to us. So instead of further delay in the entire order, we're going to go ahead and place the order now. We're going to transfer some money around in our existing budget. Because a lot of this...
That's my follow-up question on that one.
Yeah, absolutely. So we had the discussion, I want to think last week or week before, like, let's go ahead, wherever there's some additional dollars in the budget that we have allocated that we're going to use later on in the budget fiscal year, let's go ahead and transfer those funds and go ahead and get them ordered, get them installed. It may be shorter than four months, but we had to have a projected schedule. And it was important that we included that in the presentation.
Okay. And my other question was about transportation. The larger counties like Cobb, who have already started opening up in-person learning, what are they doing about transportation?
In regards to...
As far as, are they doing reduced capacity? Are they doing full capacity mm-hmm. on buses?
Some of them are doing full capacity. Absolutely. Again, these are recommendations that we, as a district, as an operations team, took a look at, and those are what we're bringing forward. But certainly, if the recommendation or the guidance is that you're going to transport 27,000 kids, three to a seat, if that's the guidance, we will implement the guidance that we're given.
Thank you.
Ms. Wade and Ms. Hines.
Thank you very much. I think these three topics are the hardest topics to address in reopening. It's the logistics and the mechanics of it that really make it very, very challenging. We can do it safely, it's just hard. And I'm glad you're in charge of these things because I think you do a good job. I want to start with the functionality. I have a list of questions and comments. And throughout here, there's some challenges about staffing. We're going to hire extra staffing, maybe have overtime. But we're going to have, let me ask you a preliminary question. Do we have rooms that are empty, no one's in, that we're cleaning every Wednesday?
If those rooms are closed off and that no one is going into those rooms, then it's not necessary that we clean those every Wednesday. But if you go into the classroom and then Dr. Brigham is in that classroom, it is just our thought that we go in and we clean them. But the plan is that if we only have 14 teachers in a building, then if you 14 would stay in your area, those are the areas that we want to go in and make sure that we're sanitizing. The media center, the front office, those areas that are being occupied, those high touch areas, just to make sure that we're going in and doing our due diligence, making sure that the floors, all of the bathrooms get a specific deep cleaning. But we're encouraging our staff, we're making sure supplies are available, that you clean up behind yourself too. Every day, you're using your computer, you're using your areas, the doors, all of those high-touch areas. We need you to clean them, but then we go in and kind of like when you pressure wash a house, we go in with our deep cleaning equipment and go in with the chemicals and clean.
Okay. And I'm glad to hear that we're not cleaning rooms that aren't being used. And I assume principals are making sure that that is not happening or being efficient. Right. And I think with the staged reopening, we also can be more efficient. So if the eighth grade wing is not open, then we don't need to be cleaning that. And so I think I hope the staffing challenges only come once we're more fully open and all the rooms are being used.
Exactly. Okay. So, and that's why you don't see that we have brought on additional staff as of yet. But as we start looking at projected dates, then it's going to be necessary that we start bringing staff in, make sure they're training, make sure they understand the proper use of the chemicals and equipment.
My next question is about the 50% capacity, and I think you said it. I just want to make sure I understand it. We're sort of using the 50% capacity as a general guideline, but some schools may be able to accommodate 60%, and some schools may only be able to accommodate 40%, right? And so we're ultimately, as far as the number of kids in the building, we're not going to draw a line at 50%, but we're going to take it on a case-by-case basis depending on
what we're doing is we're looking at the square footage of each of those classes, and we're making sure that we can maintain that 6 feet distance in between students is what we're doing.
So okay. If we want to make sure it's individualized per school when we get down to the nitty-gritty.
And that's why we made sure that you saw an elementary school, you saw a middle school, you saw a high school. What does that capacity look like? And that's a different. Believe it or not, we have different size desks. It's an older school, it's a new, but we have to keep that six. We're following the guidelines as relates to what is that safe distance between students. And right now we're being told that it's a 6 foot distance, and that's what we're trying to maintain.
Right, but I think of like a classroom, it's an old building like Savannah Arts versus Savannah High, a newer building, and those classrooms, one may be able to accommodate 60%.
Exactly. Those newer ones where we have those guidelines from the state with those classroom sizes are 650 square. We know what those newer ones are. Those older ones, you'll see us going in and actually walking those down.
Great. You referenced in the report a need for PPE, and I know the community is really, the community has really come together to support this effort. And so if there's a way for the community to donate those items, they may have access to them that we don't, that may be a way that we can, you know, ask for some support. And I had the same frustration as Mr. Johnson about the air purifiers taking 4 months since we've been in this for 6 months. Regarding transportation, to me, this is the hardest issue of all, because we're in this choice district where kids from Bloomingdale go to Tybee and vice versa. If we were in a traditional neighborhood structure, we'd be much easier to do cohorts and everything. So my thought is this is probably what's keeping us from opening more quickly, because it is so difficult. One thing I wanted to suggest is we've seen a lot of community partners really step up for the learning pods, some churches, the JEA, YMCA, and I would hope that we could work with them to discuss alternative transportation options. So I think we need to look to our community partners to assist with this. How will the cohorts be coordinated to help with transportation? So like, could we do one neighborhood is cohort A and one neighbor? I mean, can we have the cohort and the transportation work hand in hand to reduce the transportation needs, such right. that this neighborhood's not going to school on Monday and Tuesday, so we don't need to provide transportation there.
Go back to your first comment that we support kids from one end of the county to the other. That's our biggest challenge, is we sit down and look at maps and look at, you know, what are our possibilities. We're neighbors. But you would think that we would be going to the same school, we're in the same grade. But you go to a school in a different area because you made the choice and the decision to enroll in another school. So I can't take you, we can't take Vanessa and Miss Wade school together. A different bus would have to pick you up based on where you are enrolled.
But you could say everyone who lives in the Landings, regardless of what school you go to, is cohort B. And everyone who lives in Savannah Quarters is cohort A, and so you just don't go there. So I think there are ways to do it to make it more efficient. It's very difficult. Like I said, this is what the thing that is keeping us closed. I'm convinced.
It is one of those challenges that that keep us up at night.
Yes. And then I want to ask for this and for food nutrition, because we're getting lots of questions about charter schools. And I don't know if there's a time this morning where we're going to address charter schools overall, but we're hearing from charter schools, they're ready to open, they're ready to go. But what's the situation for food and transportation? As many of you know, we voted this year to allow charter schools to basically purchase the transportation from us or from others. So we can talk about that now, or if there's another time to talk about charter schools. As we know, one charter school is open, and I think the others are probably ready to go.
Okay, we'll take a look at that, and we'll be more than happy to bring back some information relative to that.
Okay, and then the last is for food delivery. As I understand it, we would not have all the cafeterias open, right?
You're correct.
Okay, and so we would just have a couple maybe around the county, and they'd be making the food for everyone.
And that's what we're currently doing now. I think there's only about 23 that are open. Miss Bonaparte, if you're there, you can shake your head. I want to think that magic number has been 21, 23, and we strategically located them around the district to allow us to not only prepare meals from there, but they are then packed, loaded on the bus, and then we distribute from those points.
And I think maybe even once we're back to normal, we could be more efficient in our cafeteria use.
We will.
So we have some lessons learned.
Absolutely. Mr. Boccia, did you want to have anything to add relative to the equipment purchase? Because there was a directive I was a little concerned about that. So we're going to be placing those orders and trying to get those in as quickly as we can. We'll continue to run those units around where we can go. And those older schools, it was very difficult to retrofit some of those filters. So that is not the only option for us. There are other options that we can consider in that period while we're having them delivered and installed. So there will be service and protection provided across the district.
Okay, Ms. Cagle, thank you very much for your report. I'm going to be short with my couple of questions I have. But I need to say that I'm having problems hearing certain folk. I'm getting the feedback with them. Their mic is down very low. So I don't know whether it's mine or not, but I hope you can hear me.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All right, very well. Well, listen, and this may have been asked before, but I'll ask it again, and then I have a short question for Mrs. Bonaparte. The schools that are over capacity now, how is this problem going to be solved?
We're going to have to make some recommendations. We'll come back and we'll tell you where we're over capacity. If there's additional space in those buildings that we could utilize, i.e. cafeterias, if labs will be an opportunity for learning space as well, we'll bring those numbers back and make those recommendations. And then we'll move from that point. We'll tell you where we have space. Believe it or not, this was a part of the conversation we had at the board retreat in January, where we saw overutilization and where we saw underutilization of buildings.
Okay, so thank
we'll
you very much.
And making recommendations for right sizing.
Okay, thank you. And Ms. Bonaparte, I would just like to ask you, how is our finance going with all the deliveries we're making and whatever? So you maybe just want to just share something with us concerning that.
Good morning. Thank you, Ms. Hines. One of the things that the department has done, the food that we did not use in the spring, We're actually cooking that food, freezing it, and transporting it to parents. So we've really saved a lot starting. We're at the point now where we're actually getting ready to order. This is what, the 14th, 15th day? So at this point, the food cost is minimum. As we go back into the models of the hybrid model, you will probably actually see an increase in food costs because now we have to do two types of menus, one for the face-to-face, because, you know, as I stated previously, we really don't want to give them cold items every day.
Right.
So in the virtual plan, we cook items. They have spaghetti, they have fried chicken, they have collard greens, and they have provided heating instructions. So the cost of food is minimum. We do have a little increase on supplies because of the way we have to pack. Everything is disposable. So when you buy wrapped items, it's a little more costly than doing a single item without plastic covering. And we use lunch trays. Now we have to use bags inside of bags inside of bags. We are definitely looking at our finances every week that we do an order. But the food that we didn't use in the spring has helped us out tremendously.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Any other questions? Dr. Hoskins Brown and Dr. Howard Hall.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And my questions can actually connect to our human resources portion. So if we are limited on time, I can just state my questions and we can hold them till later. My questions are about managing risk. And so with the additional duties and needs that we have of the custodians, I want to know what we know about risks for people providing custodial services, just in terms of general practice and how we're responding to it. what we know about risk on buses. I'm very concerned about even our reduced model, but I appreciate the adjustments that are being made in that model. But anything that we know about folks that are already busing in a reduced or full model, just what do we know about risk and transmission in that space? And also, is there a way for us to put in the survey something that asks parents whether they intend to use buses? And maybe that can let us know something about capacity and what numbers we can expect.
Thank you. Dr. Howard Hall again.
Just one more quick question. I know that the plexiglass is expensive and the supply demand is high. Mm-hmm. Have we equipped all of our secretaries, our school staff, or in other words, have all schools' front office staff been equipped with the plexiglass? I've seen some in some of the schools. They, of course, hadn't gone around and visited all of them.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Okay, and if not, is there a back order or what's the status on those?
We should not have a back order because that was one of the first initiatives that we undertook was to make sure that the front office area where that entry point is for visitors should all be fully equipped with the plexiglass, unless we had to remove some. I'm not seeing Mr. Boucher telling me that we had a problem, but all of the front office and all of the schools and office space have it. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am. 100% of the schools have been equipped with front office plexiglasses.
Yeah.
Okay. In some instances, when you have a secretary that sits off, you know, she doesn't sit in the front office, but her office may be located adjacent to that. Will those people have plexiglass or is just mainly for the front office staff?
For the front, and what we're asking, that when visitors come in for any reason, that you have them meet you at that area that we have protected you with the plexiglass.
Thank you.
If we could, it's now 10 minutes before 12. It's obvious that we're not going to get through all of this morning. Before we move forward, I would suggest that we plan a meeting at 9 o'clock next Wednesday morning, at which time there will be at least a motion from the superintendent that addresses some of the timeline, the metrics, the science that we've talked about this morning. And then I would suggest that at the beginning of that meeting, that meeting be nothing but COVID and reentry and all that face to face. But I would hope that we could perhaps do 5 and 6 at the beginning of that meeting next week, instead of trying to do it today later. I would also I've been pretty quiet this morning, and I have a lot of concerns that everybody else has, but I think some of our suggestions are being given because we care. But some of our suggestions as a board are certainly pretty operational in nature. They're pretty much suggesting how things should be done. I know that we mean well, and I know that we're all concerned about how to make it work. I would hope that as we approach the end of this meeting and this afternoon's meeting, that we remember that we are people of goodwill and that we all care deeply about this. And there's not blame to be attached. There's not, why didn't this get done sooner to be attached. You know, stop and think about, if you will, for just a minute, and I'll preach a little bit here. Then on March 15th, about, we closed up. It's much easier to close up than it is to open up, right? But since that time, think of what we've been told as a nation and as a world that has changed. we're being very careful right now about wiping down surfaces and all of that. The newest research says that the germ probably doesn't spread that way. So we're going to spend a lot of money and create more shortages in Clorox and disinfectant wipes because we are still operating under what we were told about March 20th. I was concerned about the buses and how we were going to use them. Now I'm not so sure that the buses are really one of our prime concerns. I do think that the kids are going to catch it and the staff is going to catch it from close contact, for the most part, in your halls and in your dining areas where they're pushed and the air is not circulating as best it could be. The ionization thing, that why didn't we order them sooner? Read back through your stuff, folks. They just told us 3 weeks ago that that was really good. And some people had been forthright enough and ordered it ahead of time. Good for them. But we were still trying to worry with buses and social distancing in that way. I think this has been great information so far this morning. I appreciate the board asking hard questions because they are hard questions. Ms. Wade said a few minutes ago, you know, the most difficult part of all is trying to bus the kids and get them where they need to go and get them fed so they can get to somewhere and learn. And that's not the way she said it, but that's what she said. And I agree with that 100%. I would like, if it's okay with you folks, to move on to safety precautions, and then we'll take a break, and then we'll move into executive session as a board, and we will clear the room, and then we'll come back at 2 o'clock and have our formal board meeting. Thank you. Who's doing safety?
Good morning. Good morning, campus police. You know, we continue to work diligently to support and maintain safe learning environments with the current focus on the prevention of spread of COVID-19. I have with me today Justin Pratt, who's our emergency management coordinator, who will discuss with you the current measures, safety precautions that are in place throughout the district. Justin.
Good morning. Can everybody hear me?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Excellent. Good morning. Thanks, Deputy Chief, for the introduction. I only have 6 slides, so I'll be pretty quick and brief. In campus police, we rely heavily on the emergency management process of prevention, preparedness, response, and recovery. As we prepare for more individuals to enter our facilities, we are very much leaning on the prevention practices to keep everyone safe. One of the first steps in controlling the COVID outbreak is by prevention. By managing the entry process, we can attempt to slow the spread. Steps have been put into place to ensure that everyone who enters an SCCPSS facility is wearing the appropriate PPE. Masks and face coverings shall be used when inside the facilities where others are present, including walking in narrow hallways where others travel, break rooms, conference rooms, and other meeting locations. Social distancing and frequent hand washing and sanitizing are encouraged, and reminders have been placed throughout the buildings and in the public spaces. To further emphasize and encourage these items, the Office of Communications has even produced videos on the importance of such items. Campus police has identified 2 entry-level processes, level 1 and level 2. The level 1 entry process is the initial COVID entry screening. What you experienced whenever you enter a facility currently. During level 1, entrants are asked a series of COVID screening questions. Their temperature is checked. They're issued a wristband. The wristband allows someone to enter and exit throughout the day at multiple buildings without the need to be rescreened. The wristband does not help prevent the person from having to sign in at each site. It just allows them to kind of come and go without having to go back through the process. I also want to note that the wristbands are color-coded per day. So as you know, everybody has, today is the Wednesday, it's the yellow band. That's to kind of help with identification as people come and go. Level two is security screening. That's the same screening process that we've had for all of our facilities for many years. And then once a person processes through level one and level two, they'll then be directed to sign into the building for any future contact tracing if that's ever needed. So once someone enters the facility, they're greeted with facility signage, reminding of social distancing, the use of masks, hygiene, sanitation, things of that that nature. We're placing those in public spaces, exits, elevators, common areas. We'd also like to point out that each facility has been directed to control entries into one or in some cases, two entry points to assist with the screening process. That way we ensure that everybody is passed through the process equally. As a district, we also have implemented the 615 buzzword. That's been implemented to remind everyone to maintain a 6-foot distance and limit interactions to 15 minutes or less if possible. As for visitors and volunteers, these individuals are currently not allowed into the buildings, but as we start to open our doors a little more, we do have processes in place. Currently, we're asking employees to conduct business with outside agents remotely via telephone, email, an online meeting platform such as Zoom, Skype, or Teams. If someone does have a need to physically come to a school or a facility, the measures are taken to handle their business with as little contact as possible. Plexiglass dividers in the front offices, outside if possible, just to prevent anything from coming into our facilities. Once the screening process once we do start allowing people to come into our buildings, volunteers and visitors, they will be asked to sign in, just like our employees are currently doing, for any contact tracing purposes. And then once they've passed through the screening process and the sign-in process, they'll be then given access to the location that they have intended to go to, the gymnasium, band room, a specific classroom. And then once they finish their business, they'll be asked to leave, because we do want to be able to manage knowing where somebody is going. So if we do have to contact trace, we do have that kind of under control.
Questions? Nice report. Thank you. Dr. Brinkman?
This is a broader question. I know we're doing temperature checks for teachers coming in. When we get back to the hybrid model, are we going to be doing temperature checks for students?
Lisa or Rob, are you on the line? One of them might be able to answer that a little better.
Yeah, and I don't need an answer now. It's just one of those other, again, another level of, we are doing this for our teachers. Are we going to be doing this for our students?
Yes, sir.
Good question, and we'll get that answer by Wednesday. Dr. Hoskins-Brown, please.
Oh, you're muted.
You're muted, Dr. Hoskins-Brown.
Sorry. Thank you for your report. I really appreciate the detail in it. I just have a quick question. I don't understand the daily wristband color thing. So does one person checked on one day gets... Is a different color every day?
It is. It's a different color every day. So today is yellow. So everybody in any facility has a yellow band. That way, if you go from 208 to a school site, as soon as you walk in, they'll know that you have been cleared that day.
Okay, so you get a different color every day.
You do.
Every day.
I'm sorry, say that one more time.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any other board members have their hands up? I'm not seeing any. Thank you very much for that report. As we get ready to wrap up, I'm gonna ask the board at this point, and I'm gonna start with Dr. Brinkman. Instead of, it seems like we always start with one and go all the way through eight. So today, for our meeting next Wednesday, if you had your druthers, very briefly tell me what you would like to see decided next week.
I will probably not be able to attend next Wednesday, which is fine. Please go forward with the business of the board. I truly want to see where we will draw a line of acceptable risk with our metrics. I think, you know, the first step with busing, that was a great acceptable risk. We're going to have to put two kids on each seat. What is our acceptable risk? Phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4. So that when parents ask, we can say, here are the numbers, and here are the data we're getting from the Department of Public Health. They either line up or they don't, is, I think, what I really want to see.
Okay. Thanks. I would ask, and I'm sure we're going to hear this question from other people, but I would ask if each board member would give some thought to this tonight, you know, and tell the superintendent and me what you think acceptable risk is. I think that would be very, very helpful for us all. I'm going to skip back now and get Ms. Hines, who's virtual this morning.
Well, if the question is what I feel that the acceptable risk is,
My question to you is, what would you like to see us decide next Wednesday?
As far as student reentry?
Whatever.
Okay. Well, I'm going to say, having a background in science, I'm more or less going to stick with what we are told that will be the time wherein the numbers are going down and it's safe to return.
Okay.
I would hate to see our children come back to school and we lose a child or lose children or lose faculty members or our support workers. So that I'm going to stick with the science.
Okay. So without trying to put words in your mouth, mm-hmm. the metrics are really what's most important to you. The continued look at what is acceptable in terms of numbers.
Safety.
Right, safety. Okay. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Sure.
Mr. Johnson.
What I would love to see next week is know what those metrics are, what the superintendent working with the health officials and staff, you know, what would her recommendation be? Let us talk about it, discuss it, and really hash out. And as Ms. Wade said, make those bold actions and have that bold leadership. Because right now there's a lot of anxiety within the community. And that's where I think most of our emails and phone calls are coming from, is coming from that anxiety. They just want to know. And until we have those numbers or those ranges of numbers, we can't tell them what it is. And then we're never going to release that anxiety from the community. But like I said, and like Ms. Wade said, and Mr. Cashmar said, if we have those benchmarks, if people know where they're going, where we're going, then I think we'll be able to actually do everything that we need to do in a safe and responsible manner. It's just knowing what those metrics are and know what those number ranges are.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Dr. Howard Hall.
Yes, I would like to for us to establish a benchmark as it pertains to the methods and metrics to determine exactly when our students can return to school safely. So the most important factor for me is to just establish a benchmark that determines when it's safe to return based on those measures and methods.
Thank you. Ms. Wade?
I want to see one very clear phases where we know exactly what is happening at each phase, not just grades, but ESOL and SPED, sports and clubs, very specific phase 1, 2, and 3. I want to see very specific data metrics. I want to hear about a mitigation plan. One thing we have not heard about today is what happens when we get a positive case. What does that look like? So I want to see that.
That's our name.
Oh, it is. Great. And then I want to see all levels happening in orange and yellow. I do not think it is reasonable to wait to let kids in the classroom when it is less than one per day. I would not support anything at that low level. So those are my priorities.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Hoskins, Brian.
I would like to see ranges assigned to each of the phases and a clear listing of all the groups under each phase so that when we get to the last phase, 100% of school population has been accounted for. And I also would like confirmation that we have the employees, the devices, the salary, and supply funds to fully fund virtual, hybrid, and in-person simultaneously at the safety levels that have been presented.
Thank you. Ms. Hall?
Dr. Buck, I mainly would like to have a discussion on safety versus convenience. I'd like to hear from the legal staff what our responsibilities are. Should we suffer the loss of teachers or children? And then after that, the metrics that everyone else is speaking to. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hall. Mr. Ketchmar?
Like everyone else, I'd like specific metrics for each phase, whether they're specific numbers or ranges. Number two, I'd like us to conduct the surveys that were previously mentioned for parents. I'd like to see that data on willingness or desire to return to school, and also information on transportation wants and desires for parents. I also think we should do a staff survey, and a staff wanted to come back. I think we can do the surveys for both and get that data by next week. I'd like to see enhancements to the plan that was presented today to provide in-person options for parents and staff that want them, so we're not forcing anybody to do anything. In terms of staffing, I'd like to see some enhancements to the plan that allows flexibility for each school to address their return, because some schools operate on a block model, others operate on team models. So I think we need to see that in the plan. And then finally, I'd like to see some enhancements to what we saw today to address students with disabilities. Thank you.
As the last person, I would like to begin today back face-to-face for our special ed kids and SPED kids, and especially the comprehensive kids who are in situations and parents that are untenable right now. I know that it's not ultimately our responsibility totally, but I believe that that's a limited population that we need to serve sooner than later. I also believe that we need to give real quick attention to kids with IEPs. All of those are limited numbers, but they also let us start to see faces back in a setting which will help us as we quickly approve as soon as it is safe to do so, face-to-face learning for those who choose to have it. Any final words for the good of the order? Can I have a motion to go into executive session? Mr. Johnson moved, Dr. Bringman seconds. All in favor, raise your hands. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Motion passes. We'll be in executive session. Board members that are here, I'm sure you can take a quick break. Those of you who are still at home and coming later, we look forward to seeing everybody at 2:00. Thank you.